Hello and welcome to Roll For It, where your favorite YouTubers, streamers, and role players come together to play some cool tabletop RPGs. Today, we are playing the Avatar Legends RPG, specifically the Quick Start, because of course the main rules aren't out yet, but we're very hyped for it. And in the meantime, the Quick Start's got enough for us to have some fun with. Let's introduce some of the new faces. You probably already know me and Maggie from previous Roll For It things, but we have a fresh face and a face we haven't seen in a while. Let's first of all introduce our GM, Simon.
Hello, everybody. My name is Simon. My pronouns are he, him. And I am just pleased as punch to be GMing Avatar Legends for this group of fine folks. A little bit about who I am and what I do. I'm a game designer and a LARP write, as well as a voice actor, and a pro GM for Magpie Games, as well as a moderator for the Discord. So I've done a lot of various work that you can find on my Twitter at Lucha Libris, which has links to my itch page and all that good stuff. And I'm just really excited to be here and to tell some great stories in Avatar Legends with y'all.
We're glad to have you. And of course, Banzai, we have seen you before briefly on our Steven Universe a while back, but introduce yourself for those who might have missed it.
Hello, everybody. My name is Banzai Baby. I do woodworking here on Twitch. I'm also a host on the Gen Con TV channel on Fridays. I'm just excited to be back. It's good to be back and hanging out, playing with some awesome characters. Hopefully, we'll make you all cry.
Excellent. Also, we will, we don't have her today, but we are going to have Distracted Elf from the second episode onwards. So that's why there's a weird void below me right now. But I've put the cup in there to fill the void. It's impossible, but we'll try.
I don't think we can fill that void.
But yes, let me go through the announcements and then talk about how you can support us, and we'll get underway. Today's legend tier supporter on Patreon is Hero Sheep. Thank you very much, Hero Sheep, for supporting today's premiere. We got some stuff happening on the Patreon. We have the final character sheets for Mage, the previous Saturday show, of course. They are out on the Patreon for you to check out to see how things have changed from when we posted them at the beginning. And you can also check out the guest character sheet for Queenie, our latest guest on our Thursday serial, Dungeons & Dragons Ascension. There's more stuff coming as well. There are more things from Mage, secret GM things, enemy character sheets, and other secret plots from E about how that whole thing came together. And there's also a monthly recap that will be coming out in the coming week as well. We're also sponsored by Roll20. We use Roll20 for all our shows because it's super convenient. Even when a brand new set of Quick Start rules comes out, some person goes out and makes a perfectly functional cheat code for it so that we can just like grab it and immediately start playing, and it's super convenient. It's very easy to make sheets for, and so we appreciate that there's a nice community of people out there that will always make sheets for any RPG that comes out that we can then use. It's awesome. But yeah, we use Roll20 for all the things. Super convenient way to play RPGs with friends online and roll some dice and get character sheets to do half the work for you. It's super nice. We also do giveaways from time to time. You can check out our pinned tweet on Twitter to see if there's a giveaway going on at the time, because that's where you'll find it. All right, let's talk about how you can support us. Sponsorships are great and all, but they do not keep the wheels turning. The way that we actually run all our shows and have all our cool people on them is by Patreon. You can support us on Patreon, and many people do. We super appreciate those who do. There's a whole bunch of tiers that give you a whole bunch of different rewards, including but not limited to MP3s of all of our shows, after shows we record after every show. We talk about what happens in the show, and occasionally we go off on random tangents about other unrelated things entirely, but usually we bring it back to the show in the end. You can also check out character sheets, of course. We will be publishing the character sheets for our characters in the coming week, but we might keep Elf's character secret for now. We might do it in stages.
Yeah, I think we should.
You can also
I was trying to coordinate. I was like, don't show her art yet.
Oh yeah, I did remember to hide it. I nearly didn't, but I did remember. You can also check out Secrets from Our Gems sometimes, enemy stats and other plans and things like that we will sometimes post. You can also submit names for NPCs that can sometimes get used randomly throughout our shows. And you can also watch the monthly recaps where the admins talk about how the last month went, how the shows are going, and what occasionally we'll talk a little bit about shows that are coming up as well. And sometimes drop you some hints. You can also support us at Legend tier. That's how you can support an episode like Hero Sheep did for today's episode. You can also take part in a once monthly RPG session that is just a private off-camera game that you get to be part of, Jen, by a member of the Roll For It cast. We've currently got this month, I believe.
London.
Yep, London's jamming it's something London. For the Legends, which I think is the first time he's done one of those.
Yeah, it is the first time.
Nice. You can also support us in other places too, of course. You can do the Twitch things. You can drop us bits. They will appear in the cup, which today is below me. You can try and fill that or empty that as you see fit. Sometimes people like to war over filling and emptying the cup. And maybe you can be the lucky bit that ends up floating in the corner there, like that one subscriber bit that's managed to sit on the invisible rim of the glass. You can also give us tips. They appear on the screen. We read them out at the end of the show. So thank you for being awesome and supporting the episode. And you can also, of course, subscribe on Twitch, which gives you emotes and badges, and it gives you immediate access to the Twitch VODs, whereas normally we'd have to wait 24 hours for us to upload the VODs over on YouTube. Speaking of YouTube, you can become a YouTube member. That gives you emotes and badges over on YouTube. And being a YouTube member, Twitch subscriber, or Patreon supporter, I'll let you join up to our Discord, where we got a bunch of rooms for all the things. You can talk about the shows with other fans of Roll For It and us as well. And I
dropped the art in the wiki channel.
Yeah. You can occasionally get little secret things like that too. But yeah, there's lots of different channels in there for different things about the community. We appreciate anyone who contributes to the wiki, and there's an organization room in the Discord for people coordinating wiki updating efforts, which we always appreciate greatly. You can also make clips and GIFs as well. We super appreciate when you do that. You can just you've got to time it well, because for some reason sub-only VODs can't be clipped after the fact, even if you're a subscriber or even the channel owner. We can't make clips after an episode's over. It's very weird. But if you hit the button while the show's going, you can always edit it later. And we super appreciate people making clips of cool moments. We try and use them in tweets and stuff, so you may be the one that gets featured. And you can also clip on YouTube as well. Nobody does it, but it is an option. And seeing as you can't clip after the fact with the Twitch VODs, it's good to have that option. Yeah, we appreciate the clippers. And we appreciate everyone just for being here as well. Just by showing up, you're already helping us out. You don't have to support us financially, especially if you can't. Always worry about yourself first. But if you even show up, you're already helping. You make the numbers go up and the algorithms go burr and the websites show us to more people or whatever. Who really knows how it works, but it presumably works that way. And that helps us to spread to more people. You can also cut out the middleman and tell your friends as well. Just try and bring people in, and we super appreciate everyone that brings people along. So thank you all for watching, and let's get to it. Let's hand over to our GM and start getting into trouble. Honestly, it's
the
Avatar.
I'm just
going to
be getting you all out of trouble, I feel like.
It's good to know who the Chaos Muppet and the Order Muppets are.
It's pretty much all of them are Chaos. No, I'm just kidding.
And you're the one Order Muppet. I mean, that's the job of your playbook. Yes.
Yeah.
Well, excellent. Let's talk about it. So we're playing Avatar Legends, as we said. Avatar Legends is an upcoming role-playing game from Magpie Games set in the world of the Four Nations. It is coming out very soon. It was on Kickstarter recently. If you missed that, I think you can still do late pledges if you're still interested, but soon, like December soon, because everything ships in January and February. But what this game is built on the Powered by the Apocalypse framework, which started by Vincent Negi Baker with Apocalypse World and has sort of evolved and developed over the years in lots of different ways and different styles. But the core of the game comes down to the idea that we are playing to find out something that happens. It's a very like fiction forward game, more than like mechanics first. It is a game that is very centered on the player actions, very collaborative, and also uses kind of at its crux these moves that move the fiction forward. So occasionally when someone does something in the game, like I want to jump across this chasm, I'll say, great, that sounds like you're trying to push your luck, which is a move. And then we'll turn to the dice and we'll turn to the rules to see what happens. So for those of you who have never played one of these games before, we'll sort of go through everything as it comes up rather than inundating you with all the rules at once. It is, as I said, in the world of Avatar. And so when we play, you get to choose from five different eras to play in, each of them centered around one of the avatars. So we start with Kyoshi, and then Roku's era, and then things went badly, and we have the 100-Year War, Aang's era, which takes place after the show, sort of after some of the comics, the Imbalance comics specifically, and then Korra's era, which takes place after Legend of Korra. So if you've never interacted with the show or the series, we are playing in the 100-Year War era, which is sort of just before Avatar the Last Airbender. So if you have no experience with anything, this will probably be a decent jumping off point, because you don't need to know like all of the lore and all of the characters and stuff like that. We're not going to see the characters at the end of their journeys. We might see some familiar faces before we meet them in the shows. We might not, I don't know. In this game, what you need to know is that long ago, the four nations lived in harmony. There are four nations in this world, centered around four elements: earth, air, water, and fire. And there was relative peace for a long time. That peace is often tenuous and has been negotiated very carefully by the Avatar, who is a person who has mastered all four of these elements, sort of chosen to be a protector and a bringer of balance to the world. Roku was the Avatar previously and had a hard time trying to convince his friend not to go through with this plan of proving that the Fire Nation was sort of superior to everyone and becoming more and more obsessed with power. And that didn't work out very well. He died and the Fire Nation attacked. And that's when, if you've watched the shows, everything changed, right? So for 100 years, the Fire Nation has been at war with the rest of the world, fighting to bring their culture as the dominant force across all of the lands in the world. And why is this still happening? It's been 100 years. Shouldn't the Avatar be intervening? The Avatar disappeared, and nobody knows where the Avatar went. What we know from the first episode of the show is that he was frozen in ice, running from his responsibilities, and was just trapped somewhere in the ocean for 100 years. So there should be an Avatar to bring balance to the world, and there isn't. And that means that we are living sort of in a Star Wars type world where the Fire Nation is imposing its rule over other people. They have already destroyed several cultures. The southern water tribes are demolished. The northern water tribe has been pushed back inside of the walls of their capital. They have pushed across the Earth Kingdom, which is massive, massive land mass, and just breached, like 2 years ago, the outer walls of a city called Ba Sing Se, the capital of the Earth Kingdom, which is supposed to be impenetrable. And the air nomads have taken the worst of it. The air nomads have been completely wiped out because the Avatar was from the air nomad tribes. And so they have been almost entirely eradicated, whether by direct assaults on their temples or systematic hunting. So that air nomad genocide is actually the timeline that we use to sort of signify where we are. So we're like 98 years after, 97 to 98 years after that initial attack. So, a lot of history and a lot of pain and a lot of suffering in the world. Where our story begins is in Ba Sing Se. The other thing that we do at the top of the game is that we establish sort of a pilot episode. So we don't need to go through like a, well, how did our characters meet? We already did that. We had a little chat and we talked about our characters met. And they have a unifying goal. So if you imagine we are in our TV show, right? We've just done the opening credit crawl. And then previously on Avatar, this black text, right? So what we see is a group of people kind of making their way into this massive, massive bustling city. It's this huge ringed city, giant 100 meter tall walls that surround it on the outside. Inside, farmland for a while, right? And then after several acres of farmland, another wall, a ring of walls, and then another ring and another ring until finally you reach the palace in the middle, elevated above everything else. It's very structured city. A scruffy looking outsider from the east coast of the Earth Kingdom wanders in to the city, looking around. He's here to make a name for himself. He's here to do something in the big city, right? Everyone thinks that he's a screw up, but he's here to prove that he's going to be someone you don't want to overlook, right? Don't underestimate this guy. He's going to make his bones out here. And is invited by the Minister of Morale, Li Jing, this very well put together man who is like, welcome, welcome to our city. Let me show you the hospitality. Takes him in, but is being followed by an older bodyguard who is protecting a young noble. And they are suspicious of Li Jing. They've been for a little bit. They know something's weird. And at the same time, we also have a soldier from the Earth Kingdom also kind of on the trail of Li Jing, trying to figure out what's going on. Because this soldier knows the war's going on and has discovered that in the city, people don't seem to know there's a war, which is strange. We see our scruffy character in a tea house, very nice tea house with a whole bunch of other people, as Li Jing offers these cups of tea brewed from red jasmine, this very beautiful ruby jasmine, which is a special, very special flower known for its very delicious calming properties. And is about to drink it, but notices that everyone else at this party, after they drink it, they enter this sort of trance-like state. It's like they're not in control of themselves. And in the process of trying to figure out what's going on, the people spying reveal themselves. There's a fight, there's a scuffle. And in the process, the devices that are used to brew and steep this tea are destroyed, attracting the ire of Li Jing. And narrowly, our characters escape. So all of that is sort of what we did in the pregame. We set up these three plot points, and now we know the main structure. So where we begin our game is on the streets of Ba Sing Se, barely an hour after this happens. We see three characters out of breath, panting. It is dark, it's night. The streets are lit by paper lanterns that I think are swaying in a wind. There's a drizzle, there's a rain that's starting to come down, and people are kind of hurrying inside. And the three of you are sort of pressed up against a wall in an alleyway as you hear footsteps of guards running down the street, going after them. Where's, look, go that way. They went that way, right? You're trying to catch your breath after just escaping capture. What I'm going to say is that everyone should mark 2 fatigue and 1 condition.
Dude, to represent right
the stress
away,
of your narrow escape.
One condition.
Right. One condition of your choice.
I think that in that moment, the first thing that Quan Zhenya says is she kind of like looks around and notices that Delight is not with them and is like, did anyone see Delight? And I think I'm going to be insecure about this because my job is to protect her.
Your job is to protect Delight, who is not here. Yeah. And who, what is your character look like? So you're the first person to speak. The camera swings from these like three silhouettes and we get a close up on Quan Zhenya. What do you look like?
Yeah. Quan Zhenya is kind of a more elderly looking person in this group, mostly by like the wrinkles on her face. But she is pretty dexterously built. So at first glance, maybe you wouldn't notice until you got close to her and saw her face. But she's a bit androgynous because of her build and because she's been just a kind of almost like a soldier, but more, you know, bodyguard to a noble family for her entire life. She has really long gray hair with bits of strands that are kind of coming over her headband that she wears. It's like made of leather. She's got the rest of it in like a big ponytail that kind of like dangles about. In her hands, you can probably see these yin-yang tomahawks that she's got. And she's primarily garbed in, you know, clothing that looks like Earth Kingdom clothing, but probably a little bit nicer than, you know, the everyday villager type. She's got like little bits of gold accoutrements and like a pin that is on her that has like a symbol on it as well for the family that she's a guardian of. She's got like a little rope belt and leather boots, and she has her arms are wrapped, it looks like.
Nice.
Yeah.
I think I saw her get away. They carried on chasing us for a bit, but we might be all right now.
Well, yes. I think I kind of pointed out some areas that I know that maybe she hid. I don't know. She's lively enough. I'm sure she's safe, but man, I should have caught that. That seemed too easy to get stuck in something like that.
So as the two of you speak and are getting your bearings, tell us what each of your characters looks like.
Jian looks like a, he's a kid on the older side, like, late teens sort of area, but what he's wearing is components of a well-worn military uniform of the Earth Kingdom. It is his size. He didn't like, you know, steal it or get it passed down. It looks like it's been made for him, but it's definitely it's been through the wars. It's dirtied and tattered in places. But it's still mostly intact. There's bits missing. He doesn't have the big hood and the armored shoulders and things like that. But he's wearing like the main components of it. What he still has to his possession. He's got his hair in a headband. It's a little bit messy, and he's looking a bit scared right now. He's just been confronted with a lot, so I've marked afraid for the moment. And he's kind of shiftily looking around to make sure no one's coming around any corners for him.
Mm-hmm. She is I want to say in between a late 20s, early 30s kind of individual. Can't really tell. Looks like they've seen a lot in their life. You know, dodged a few things here and there. Kind of darker complexion, more of from that of the eastern area. And whereas their outfit is a very dark earth tone kind of like thing, but still like fitted, but loose and well worn, kind of look like maybe it's been through a lot of rough patches. Maybe something that you would definitely see someone of a highwayman standard of wear and attire, no hint whatsoever. And they're just kind of like checking around and kind of, he's kind of huffing and puffing about, you know, that's the easiest trick in the book, how to like make sure you can, you know, get people here and there. It's so easy. Why didn't I just think of that? So I did mark down his anger being as something I so foolishly, because somebody had an official title and money, they
can't trust a big smile like that, right? Especially not in the big city. They warned you. They warned you, Chi. And here it is. So the three of you are sort of catching your breath and realizing that your companion, your fourth friend who was here, has gone missing somewhere in the chase. So we don't know what happened to Delight, but maybe we'll find out. I mean, we will find out next session, obviously. But you, right now, you're like, huh, okay. So you still hear the patter of feet kind of running back and forth. So like the streets in this part of the city are busy with guard activity, and people don't want to deal with that. The people kind of around you, you hear, and what you see, what you've seen kind of in the process of like running through the city at night, are people kind of closing their doors and closing their windows. I'm like, okay, something's going on. There are criminals about or something like that. We don't want to be bothered. Another thing that we should address is because Delight is missing. Every character in this game has a playbook, which is not really a class so much as it is a narrative arc. When you pick your playbook, you're sort of picking both a collection of abilities as well as a story thread to carry your character through. So we have Quan is the guardian, and the guardian's whole thing is that they have a ward that they are trying to protect. They're also juggling sort of these ideas of relying on your own, your skills and yourself versus trusting others. So it's a delicate balance to strike. And because Delight is not here, your ward for this session is going to be someone else, which is Chi, right? You've decided that Chi is the person who you're going to try to protect. Mm-hmm. So at the beginning of each session, you're going to roll.
My burden move.
Yes, the protector's burden move triggers. So the structure for moves in this game is like, when blank in the fiction happens, this thing happens. This game effect happens. We might roll dice. We might do something else. Something just might happen. In this case, we're going to roll dice, which means we roll 2d6. And for this move, you're going to add +1 for each yes to these questions. Do you believe that Chi listens to you more often than not?
Probably not.
No. Okay. Have you recently protected Chi or helped them with a problem?
I believe so.
Yes.
We just escaped. Yeah.
That's exactly what happened. And is there an immediate threat to your ward that you are aware of?
Yeah.
Yeah. Uh-huh. Right. There's guards. There's this minister. So go ahead and roll and add +2 to your roll.
It's a hit. 9.
Okay, great.
And a 7 to 9, I get to hold 1.
Yes. So in this game, in this framework, generally speaking, a 7+ is a hit, and a 6 or lower is a miss, quote unquote. So a 7 and 9 is sort of like a soft hit where you get some of what you wanted, but there may be a complication or a cost. And a 10+ means that it's a strong hit and you get all of what you wanted with very few complications, if any, or you do something exceptionally well. Whereas a miss means that things get complicated. Not necessarily that you fail, but that things don't go the way you planned.
I take -1s going forward when I try to like help them. In this case, I get to take 1 because I only rolled a 9. A 10+ I would get to take 2. So I'm going to take a 10+ on any move to defend or protect them. Although the figure out what they're up to without them knowing is was a secondary one that I was contemplating. But I'll
okay. So
I'm
good
a protector
news.
At heart.
What you get is a resource called Hold. And hold is something that you carry until it's no longer fictionally applicable. So you don't have to spend this right now.
I don't have to pick yet.
Yeah. You have one hold because you rolled a 9, and you can spend that at any time to again, take plus 10 on a move to defend or protect that person. So to Chi. Track down Chi, even if they are hidden or avoiding you, or figure out what Chi's up to without them knowing. So whenever that comes up in the fiction, you can be like, hey, I have a hold and I'm doing this thing. So that's the start of things, is like you're kind of you've got a little bit of protection prepped for this situation. So what happens here? Now that you've kind of had a moment to like think, you need to make a plan.
Because
you just escaped from a dangerous situation. You revealed yourselves to Li Zheng, the Minister of Morale, and Li Zheng's guard. Like there were soldiers and people like involved who were there. The civilians didn't seem to notice anything of what's going on because they drank this tea. They were completely out to lunch. They were just totally gone. But there are people looking for you. And what I'm going to do is hint at something that's about to happen, which is that you hear those boots going, something down here. Like maybe when you like came in here, something like you bumped up against a crate or something in it like a bottle fell and cracked. You hear voices from the edge of this alleyway saying, I heard something over here. I'm going to check it out. What do you do?
Quan is immediately going to look to Chi because Chi had just mentioned, Delight like went to one of the places I talked about. And Quan will say,
well, do you know where one of those places is now? Because we need to find ourselves invisible. All right, let me look around really quick at the alleyways and then can I go ahead and enact one of my moves already for this?
What are you doing?
I'm gonna go, here's the plan to help out because I feel like we need somebody. I'm trying to think what would be the better, well, let's roll first to see if I even get it.
Well, before we even get to the dice, how are you laying out this plan? So you have a move, which is when you work out a plan with someone, roll with creativity. And so you get to say like, this is sort of the huddle up moment of like, all right, here's what we're gonna do. Boom, boom, boom. So what are you doing in the fiction? Are you laying out a plan? Are you looking for a way out?
That's why I looked around really quick to see if there's any necessary markers still on the wall where I know where there would be like some kind of marker for the totally legit negotiations of very duty-free people. If you know, very legit businesses will know these markers and guides. And let's just say I found one of them. So like in my like zoom out mind, I go, okay, so we have to go ahead and really quickly, we are on this street. Let's go ahead. We are on, we just happened to run in Harmony Street. And if we take Harmony Street down two passes and then we'll on the corner, there's going to be a hat seller. And then from the hat seller, you take the stairs right behind the hat seller up two floors, jump off of two balconies and then go down what looks like a chimney, but is actually a slide to a safety area.
Okay.
I know the guy. I know the guy here that let us. Yes.
What I think this is actually an assess the situation. So when you assess a situation, because you're like, okay, I'm racking my brains, I'm looking around, what do I do? This is sort of about gaining that information and seeing if it's a viable plan, right? Mm-hmm. So go ahead and roll with your creativity.
Okay. And go. Aha! Mixed.
Okay, it's great. So it's a 7 and 9 result. So when you get a 7 and 9, you get one question from a list of options for assist the situation. And that sounded to me like you were asking, what's my best way out?
Right? Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yes.
So we're going to use what you just kind of bumbled out as like, we go this way and then this way and then this way. And we end up with the hat seller, right? So it seems to me Like, Chi has a good head for directions. It's just, like, good at orienting themselves in space. And you're right. You're absolutely right that, like, oh, yeah, if we slip down this way, barely anyone was on these side streets earlier. Like, it's clearly not, it's a bunch of, like, back alleys for restaurants and stuff like that. Nobody's going to be going down that way. And then we loop around here and then go up this way. And I remember this guy had a little hiding spot. So you're right. Your plan of escape is 100% on the money. So all of you, what do you do? Do you like start like shoving people in that direction? Do you start running?
I follow.
I will start running as, you know, like not like blah, 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 but like really, I'll just like tug on them and say, follow me. I know where to go.
So you're off like a shot and Quan's right in pursuit. Jian, what are you doing?
If Chi's got a plan, Jian doesn't, so he's going to follow.
Okay, so the three of you go off, Chi blazing the trail, Quan, like, all right, I'm watching you, and Jian's like, wait, don't leave me, right? So you start running. Around the corner, someone goes, hey, stop! and you've been spotted. So, like, you've got a way out. You know the way, like, to kind of elude them, but someone knows that you're here. So you hear footsteps kind of pursuing you from behind. So you run down these side streets, you go back up the other one, you pass the hat seller, right? This is night, so there's not a lot of activity going on. And what was the, do you remember where you said you would end up at all?
It was down a chimney. You mean down the chimney?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Down a like, chimney.
Yeah, like it's a slide that takes you into a safe place. Is that what it was? Yeah.
Yes.
Like a safe house.
So it's not a real chimney. It's just a slide that goes in. So there's no smoke that. Yeah.
Okay.
But this you have to jump. Yeah.
We're in the, I think I said, I might have said middle ring earlier. I think it's more interesting if we're in the lower ring. So the Ba Sing Se, as we said, is like this massive city. Which is farmland and then kind of lower class areas, middle class areas, upper class areas, quite literally the lower, middle, and upper rings as they kind of go higher and higher up as you go further in. So the lower rings are huge and they're kind of, if you imagine, all kinds of mostly residential areas, but there's also like factories and things like that. So I think you're right. You all jump down this slide and end up in like a coal pit. So this is like where people deposit coal for heating purposes, like for a nearby factory or something like that, or to heat cook fires. But the three of you just come stumbling out covered in soot.
I like it.
And above you, because you've had this like this planned out, you're like, where'd they go? I don't know. I didn't see. Check over that way. Go down back down Harmony Street. Oh, you take two contingents. You go this way, right? So they sort of start spreading out. So they're still on alert, but they don't know where you are right now. And you are gathering your wits in this coal storehouse. You have a moment of quiet for once. What do you do?
Could you not have pitched something less dirty? Well, when you're covered in dirt, it's harder to see at night, you know? You just kind of disguise yourself. I'll go ahead and take the coal and start smudging my face even more.
And you're just like covering yourself in dirt.
Quan's seeing that. Actually, that's pretty clever. And then kind of nods at that thought process.
I'm like, oh, this makes sense.
At first being like, and then being like, okay, I'll let it slide.
So the three of you have a moment of relative peace, but you know that as long as those guards are still looking for you, there's still danger out there in general. And there's a lot on your mind, right? You've discovered this secret plot. There's a lot going on. You're missing a friend. You don't have anywhere to go. One of you does, but the other two of you are recent arrivals, right? Gian has just come to the city to be like, I need to find people, right? Hmm. Let's have a moment as you're sort of like figuring out what you're doing and cleaning yourselves off, or in some cases, like trying to apply soot to your clothing to sort of make it harder for you to see at night. We kind of flashback. We see Gian, and we cut to a village, a fishing village on the western coast of the Earth Kingdom. Eastern. Oh, you're from the East Coast.
Hmm.
Okay. So that's on the eastern coast of the Earth Kingdom. And it is burning. It is on fire. And Gian is standing there with his parents, who are like all embracing. And in the distance, we see these massive metal warships with the Fire Nation flags snapping in the wind. And then your parents sort of like look down at you, and Gian's mother, I-10, looks at Gian. Was this what caused Gian to join the military?
No, he had already, so he's already, he's in his uniform, and he didn't do it. It didn't work.
Yeah. So your mother kneels in front of you and like puts her hands on your shoulders and says, Gian, I know you want to fight, but I can't lose you. We've lost everything. I don't know what I would do if I lost you two. What do you do?
He's gonna look back at the scene. Commander Chen told me to go to Ba Sing Se. We can find help there. We'll take the road and I can protect us on the way.
And she starts to cry and stands and just sort of like snaps very harshly. And what will happen when the war comes to Ba Sing Se? They won't stop, Gian.
I don't know, maybe we can find some more help there. Maybe there's... If everyone gathers there, we'll be strong enough to hold them back.
It's always about being strong enough. We don't always have to be strong. Sometimes, when the wind blows the tree, it can break if it resists too much. And she's just standing there with tears in her eyes, and your father, Huang, right, like puts his arms around her. It's like, we'll go to the city. I hope for your sake, for all of our sakes, you're right, that there's hope. And we fade back to the city, to the scene here, where people don't seem to be aware that anything has happened. Even your first day or two in the city, nobody seemed to be aware that there was a war or that anything was happening outside the city walls. So what are the rest of you doing as you're gathered around here And you look over and you see Gian sort of like wistfully looking in the distance.
Are you all right, young one?
It's just, it's starting to make sense. Why everyone here is pretending everything's fine, they're suppressing the truth. That guy, Li Zhang, he's trying to make everyone pretend that there's no war, that we're just safe in here. But if everyone pretends that everything's fine, then they're not fighting. We need to be fighting.
Yes, Delight and I have been suspicious of him for quite a bit of time now.
But at least to me, that makes no sense. Like, don't you want your folks to know? I've never really lived in the city for that long. I come in and come out, but like, wouldn't it be better to be prepared? Like, I don't understand.
Well, they have their own army and they think the walls will protect them.
I can assure you that walls can be easily got through, just saying. I don't know. It seems quite strange indeed. Yeah, they're still outside.
We have to stop this guy.
There are many walls, but none quite like that of the Earth Kingdom. And I agree, Jean, but we can't just go running out into the wilderness.
I don't want to run out into the wilderness. I want to, you know, raise an army. There's earthbenders in here that aren't even, they don't even know that there's anything to be fighting for.
I agree.
We don't just need the walls to hold. We've got to go and fight them. We've got to go and push them back.
And how do you think we should go about that?
I don't know, but I think
what's out there.
It starts with the truth. Everyone needs to know what's happening.
You must be careful with that truth. If they see you spreading these words, well, you'll go missing like some of the others have.
I've worked out that much so far.
Missing. So, I mean, if there... Maybe we already have an army ready. If there are people missing, that means maybe they're keeping them somewhere, then no one would be so inhumane to just not have them, wipe them from the earth. I mean, well, except for the Fire Nation, I guess.
I think it's something to do with what they were trying to do to you.
Yes, they were trying to give you tea. There's something in the tea. That is what Delight and I have figured out. That is why we are trying to stop you from drinking it. Gee.
Whew. Well, thank you for doing that. Just, wow.
It seems to suppress their worry. They think of nothing else but their daily things that they must dote upon. Some kind of mind control or... I don't know.
It's not right.
No. Can't enslave
people. What do you suppose? My thought was that if they're giving this tea to folks, they must be making it somewhere, right? Perhaps we find the source of where the tea has come from, and we stop the transport of it to the city.
Right. That makes sense.
Yes. That is a very sound idea. See, this is why you are a leader official there, Juan.
Perhaps not so much. I have not kept my eye on Delight.
and you can see Quan look worried, and Quan usually is pretty sturdy person, and always, like, you know, has some semblance of a plan, but since the moment we realized Delight wasn't with us, she's been kind of relying on you guys more than she normally is.
I think she'll go be ahead and
take my hand and put it on Quan's shoulder and be like, Quan, you might not know this, but I have worked with Delight before, and she's a very resourceful child. I highly believe, although she may seem naive, she's got a good head and she's smart, and she, you know what? You taught her to survive. And I know you care a lot about Delight, but just have faith in what you taught her. She's a smart kid.
I appreciate that.
She... But that sounds like Chi is comforting or supporting Quan. So Chi,
yeah,
go ahead and
roll. Yeah, let's see how that roll goes
karmic.
First, whether I take it or not. Yeah. Never mind.
Oh, it's a passion, right?
I will hold my response.
Yeah, that is a passion one. All right, good luck to me.
It's harmony. Comfort or support is harmony.
Oh, harmony. Okay, sorry.
Yeah.
Harmony.
And also,
passion is more like I'm going to intimidate you.
While you were talking about, like, we have to go out and fight, we have to go put it, it sounded like you were hyping yourself up to be like, there's, like, we need to do something, right? I'm going to shift your balance towards force one step for that.
And I think the
GM gets
insecurity.
To make moves in addition to, like, everyone else sort of doing things as they trigger them in the fiction. And one of my moves lets me kind of push people's balance around, which is something we haven't super talked about. We kind of alluded to it, but everyone has two principles that they're juggling, which are unique to their playbook. So as the guardian, Quan is kind of balancing self-reliance and trust, right? Do I rely on my own instincts, or do I trust that other people know how to take care of themselves? Chi is the bold playbook, right? Sort of your Sokka type, like, I'm gonna be the best there ever was, and I need everyone else to know that, right? You're balancing loyalty versus confidence. And Jian is the hammer. The hammer is sort of like early Korra, right? I'm gonna punch the problem in the face. And I'm gonna get really frustrated when I can't punch the problem.
Korra just makes a lot of bad decisions. She's like, how many bad decisions can I make and just not stop?
I'm the avatar, you gotta deal with it, right? So Jian is balancing care and force, right? When is the time to fight and when is the time to show a softer hand? So right now, Jian is feeling, we fight. So force is kind of the direction you're going in. And it looks like you did pretty well there. You got a mixed success there on your comfort or support. So on a 7 and 9, your target, Quan, decides if she opens up to you or not.
What's the question that you ask? Because it's kind of like a question that you ask as you're...
Well, you were like, you gotta trust that you taught Delight how to take care of herself. You know, you're a good person was sort of the mission statement there, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just trust.
I think Quan does open up and says,
you know, sometimes I question the things you do, but you're right. Delight is clever and creative. She'll figure out a way out, and we'll find her. I'm certain of it.
And I will remove my insecurity, I think, for that.
I made enough noise.
It doesn't make sense for the fatigue part. I think I'm still tired.
You're still physically exhausted, for sure.
Yeah.
I think I made enough noise to keep the guards on us rather than her.
Con will nod. And she's going to kind of like look around and see if there's I guess I'm the only one who actually has a place to stay here, so I think I'm going to try to get these guys to a safe like place where we could sleep and rest and come up with a plan. So kind of checking to make sure that like the coast is clear type of thing.
Yeah, so you're looking out the window and double checking everything. Mm-hmm. So I think this is a rely on your skills and training moment. So every character has a training, which represents how they defend themselves, right? So it's either one of the four types of bending, earth, air, fire, and water, or weapons or technology. Those are your six training styles. And you choose a fighting style within that. Like if you're an airbender, maybe you use the sonic vibrations of an instrument and amplify those in your particular style. Or maybe if you're a waterbender, you freeze ice and you like throw ice spears at people. That's kind of like the way that you've specialized in your bending type. But you also have backgrounds, which represent your character's upbringing. Quan, you
have a military urban
background and an urban background, right? Because you live in the inner ring, in the upper ring.
Mm-hmm.
I think that means that you know the city very well. You've been all over the place. You know the monorail system. You know like which like how to flag down like a pedicab and everything like that. So for this moment, I think you're relying on your urban background to gain new insight, which is like, where's a place that we can light up, right?
Yeah.
So go ahead and roll with your focus.
Oh, focus, not my strong suit. But I had an 8.
Not bad.
The worst.
So on a hit, you do it, and on a 7 to 9, you do it imperfectly. So I will tell you how your approach might lead to unexpected consequences, which you must accept, or you can mark a fatigue and say, and sort of avoid the worst of it. So you're poking your head out the door, and you're like trying to rack your brains about where we can lay low and everything, right? I think there is... I think it's not finding the way out that's the problem. It's the fact that you're all just like soaked and covered in soot. That like, if you're trying to hide yourselves like in the shadows, you can darken your clothing with it for sure, but you're gonna leave a lot of soot behind. And so-
I was actually thinking we might wanna take the soot off because I have some semblance of authority. So as long as we look clean, I think that maybe we could get away with a little bit more.
Okay. So maybe you're cleaning yourself off like ahead of time.
Yeah.
In which case, I think that the unexpected consequence is that like you can get out, but these guys are everywhere. And so unless you push yourself extra hard to like recall guard timetables and schedules of like, okay, who's on what shift now and who's on the take and which person can I actually talk to about these things, someone's gonna know you were in this general vicinity, right? Like you lost the guards at first. Right now they don't really know where you are. They kind of have a general idea. The consequence is you'll be able to get to a safe house, but someone is gonna like be aware that you're moving. Like someone will rat you out and be like, hey, I saw some weird people going this way, right? So do you wanna take that consequence that they know that you're in the vicinity?
Yeah, I'm fine with taking that consequence.
Okay, cool. So they will know kind of like where you are, but they won't descend on you.
Yeah, we kind of left like a city trace from behind in that area.
So where would you go to hide out? You're in the lower ring right now. What do you have a safe house out here? Do you know of like a gambling house or something like that? What do you think?
I think that Quan has, there is a fabric dealer who lives down here, and although they aren't well known, they do tend to find ways to get some really, really nice fabric from other places. And Juan hasn't told people where she gets the fabric from, but she always gets like a deal on it. And then she takes part of the money from that. And she's saving it to send back to her family. So I think that there's like some things that she does that Delight's family might not know. And this is maybe one of those things.
You've got some friends and connections that are, you know, outside of the purview of this rich family that you've been bodyguarding for. Yeah.
Exactly.
Okay. So you know that there's that fabric shop. And you also know that, like, dang it, you know, the guards do patrol around there pretty often. Like, maybe it's in a decent, like a slightly nicer part of the district, or maybe it's in a worse part of the district. Maybe that's why there's more guard presence. But one way or another, like, for it's surprisingly good quality for being out in sort of a much lower income area. And I think that the owner takes pride in that. So what we see is, you know where that is, right? I assume you inform everyone, like, hey, I know a place where we can go hang out. Yeah.
I know someone. I have not visited them in quite some time, but I think they will help us.
Well, works for me.
I mean, I have. Yeah, works for me. I have no plan. But you haven't seen them. Can we trust them?
I believe we can trust them. I don't trust very oft, but they have a good heart.
So,
just don't steal anything.
I look specifically at Chi.
You.
No, borrowing is what I do. Borrowing, never stealing. That's
whatever you call it. Don't do that. And we'll need to clean up a bit before we head that way. There are quite a few guards running about, but I have my ways around them.
All right, so you sort of dust your way up, and we have a couple like montage moments of you like poking your head out the door of this coal storehouse. There's some workers who are still like, they're on their way out. You know, it's late, but some people are quote unquote burning the midnight oil, as it were, who are still working here. Maybe there's a night
Someone
shift.
Someone sees us though.
Right. No one's like, you're always like slipping out the back. Like, okay, you're in the shadows while they're in the foreground, or vice versa. And you make your way through these long winding streets. The lower ring is cramped. It's a lot of houses built next to each other. It's not as bad as it becomes in about 100 years when we get to Korra's era. The lower ring is pretty jank by that point in time. But you can see kind of where the building blocks are. Mm-hmm. So it's a lot of these buildings in kind of off-white stone or in wood with black tiles on their curved roofs. And everything kind of looks the same in certain parts, depending on like on how many embellishments are in the area. Like, oh, there's some like paper lanterns out here. There's some like a banner or a sign that shows a great noodle shop or whatever. But if you're not from around here, it can be easy to get lost.
Light a torch or something that we can use for light.
Yeah, you could grab like a lantern off of something and just sort of like walk your way around. And so we see you.
Well, I was thinking making fire.
Oh, you make a torch, right? Because you're a firebender.
Yeah.
Spoilers. So you make you like grab like a little like a log on the way out maybe and whoom, create this
Take
torch.
Take some of the whatever you call it.
The kindling. And
yeah, because we're in like a coal thing, right?
Yeah,
so,
yeah.
Yeah.
Would this so you have this makeshift torch.
Will this be the first time I see Quan firebending?
Probably, unless you used it in the fight.
I would assume that I probably used it in the fight, right?
Yeah. So you know fighting. That Quan is a firebender, which is weird.
Yeah.
Yeah, I probably didn't have too much time to think about it in like the escape, but then when I'm reminded, I'm
right.
Like,
I so imagine I just pick up one of the coal, like if you don't mind. I manage and I pick up one of the coals and I just kind of like touch it and it like light and the little flame just on it.
Yeah.
Yeah. And that's what I'm carrying.
That's quite
around.
Useful.
Or maybe I'm like covering it.
Mm-hmm.
So, where are you from again?
Quan will just brush off the question. And she's like looking around. She's like,
we need to move quickly. Come on now.
You can push if you want, but she does it initially.
Seem interested yeah. in.
Jean definitely hesitates, but then he's like, I mean, I'm out here and there's guards after me. I don't have much choice right now. And it's just going to keep following.
Right. So perhaps with a more suspicious eye. Mm. So we see this like, oh.
Right. And when you do ask her that, when she's looking out, she's kind of, with one hand, she has like the coal that has the flame on it. But with her other hand, she kind of goes and clenches a necklace that has that she's like holding the pendant of. She says that she like kind of like is looking around. Simon's like, I know what that is.
You all technically know what that is. But yeah.
Behind the scenes.
Sweet. So you pass your way in there. And so we cut to outside this fabric shop, which I think is kind of a two-story building, which is not uncommon, but not super common fancy. In this area. It's like pretty decent. Like this person's done pretty well for themselves with a big
kind that's
of
not sus at all.
Wooden doors, right? There's a sort of like a back, I imagine like a stock room in the back or something like that. It's got another entrance, but you're knocking on the front with this torch. What kind of person is this? Are they like really friendly? Are they like terse but gets the job done? What's the vibe, are you thinking?
I think they're probably an overly jovial person, which is like the complete opposite of Quan.
Yeah, perfect offset.
And just like energetic and excited. They're a salesperson. They could sell you anything. They could have like a little, you know, fire ferret's poop nugget and they could sell it to you. Like that's how how good of a salesperson they are.
You could sell water to fish, right?
Yes, exactly.
Okay. So this is like a business as well as a home, I think. And so this person and on the inside, this kind of very sing-songy voice is like, we're closed, but if you come back in the morning, I'm sure I can help you then.
Well, that might be a bit difficult, old friend. It's me, Quan.
The door creaks open a hair, I think pretty decently dressed person, I think has more color.
Maybe like flamboyantly dressed.
Yeah.
I like the idea that they're just a little eccentric.
Yeah. I think it makes total sense for like a fabric merchant too.
Yeah.
It takes pride in your work. Like maybe it's like, I want to show you what I can give you, you know, I'm showcasing the product. I think, because most of the lower classes in the Earth Kingdom in general, especially in Ba Sing Se, tend to wear like browns, off-whites, some greens, and the nobility has a lot more color variation in terms of like the tones of those, but also like turquoises and golds and things like that, like pure black, white, things that, you know, dyes cost
money. Imagine this person's like the person who goes to sleep with like those giant like feathery like, you know, pajamas where like there's just like feathers on. Like, who sleeps like that? No one does. But this person would.
The murder dress, is that what you're talking about?
Like a house coat. So I think that's how they come out, is like they're wearing like a kimono with like long sleeves that kind of hang loose, so it's this extra fabric, and there's this kind of trim. I think it's white trim. And it's a turquoise, like jewel tone silk kimono that is like tied tight with a sash. Hair is up in curlers for the evening. and like looks out. Like, I said, I'm so sorry. Quan, darling, it's so good to see you. What are you doing out so late? Goodness me. And you brought company. Oh, I wish you'd told me. I would have put a pot on.
Well, perhaps I can tell you some more if you don't mind us staying for a little while. I don't mean to barge in on you and all, but we've got ourselves in quite a pickle.
The pickle's exist. I don't think I've ever seen a pickle, actually. Cabbage.
Yeah, pickled food is like been around for a while, even in rural times.
I just don't think I've ever seen pickles in Avatar.
Yeah, there's you like maybe cabbage. A dozen dishes they show.
Yeah, you've got cabbage. We've got cabbages. Got ourselves a cabbage here.
All kinds of cabbages.
That's what I thought.
But you can pickle cabbages, so you could have pickles, but they might be of cabbage.
Mm-hmm. Pickled cabbage.
Yes.
We've got ourselves in a pickled cabbage, you might say.
So the this person, who I'm going to call Feng Ma, takes you in and is like, a pickle? Oh my goodness. I'm not used to these kinds of things happening outside of a stage play. Closes the door and is like busying themselves very much so with like being a good host. So you're in, you come into this shop. This is the showroom, basically. And so it's wall-to-wall bolts of cloth, stacks of different fabrics and textiles and different style shapes and sort of tones. There's a counter, and then there's sort of a back room that Feng Ma like rushes off to and is bustling around in, like a little kitchenette. Mm-hmm. And it comes back sort of to the counter and sets out cups. And starts like getting some tea ready.
Oh, you're too kind. You don't have to do that.
When I get a chance, I will take their hand and respectfully like press it towards my forehead and then give a little wink, like, such a gracious host you are, and such, for letting a poor soul like me in. By the way, I'm Chi.
She's hitting
of course you are. The pleasure is mine, really. Quan, you didn't tell me you had such charming friends.
I wouldn't call that one charming.
And where's that lovely girl, Delight? Where's...
Well, I'm not quite sure where she is at the moment, but I'm sure she'll turn up again.
I should hope so. Aren't you her bodyguard?
Yes. Well, there's more to that story.
Please, please have something. And it's like pushing like tea and some sweets into your hands. And it's like, oh, listen, it is lovely to catch up, but staying the night, board, room and board. Quan, my dear, I am a tailor and a merchant. I am not a boarding house.
Quan will pull out like a bag from around her waist and set it on the table. You hear like the clinking of coins, and she's like,
I understand this is not your forte, but we need a place to stay, and I'll pay just as I would for any of these bolts.
And I'm probably the reason this place has so much.
You give a lot of business here.
Yeah.
Yeah, for sure.
I maybe only do business every once in a while, but it's like big amounts of, you know, money that is going to the noble family.
Yeah. I think this is a plead. So when you plead with an NPC, who cares what you think specifically? You can't plead with people trying to catch you. For help, support, or action, harmony? Roll with harmony. Yes.
Ooh, I'm not very good with harmony, but. Uh-oh. Shall try.
Could I aid in that roll?
You could. So after Quan rolls,
yeah.
If there's like a, if you get a six, you could assist and bring it up to a seven. Or seven. If she gets a nine, you could bring it up to a 10. So it's a seven already.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So no worries about assisting. Yeah. But if you want to assist in general, after someone rolls, you can mark a fatigue. and add +1 to their roll. So it doesn't do anything if you rolled like a 7 or an 8, because it's only going to bring it up to a 9, and that's still in the 7.
But it'll be helping with fatigue, though.
Right. You spend your fatigue to do it, and also fictionally you have to be able to assist, you know, in some way. So you could be like, oh, I'm like, let me help you sweet talk. Like, hey, remember this moment
that's
we just
the,
had?
Yeah, the moment and be like, oh, I know it's such an inconvenience to a personage of your great nature, but as you can see, it's just... I've just newly come into the city. My clothes are not as ragged. We just need a rest and look at your poor friend, Quan, you know, the ward. Delight is somewhere out there missing. And don't you feel like they just need a moment to rest and recuperate? Only, of course, a dear friend like yourself who has been dealing with Quan for so many years would just, you know, find it in your beautiful heart. Because I'm sure you're both in beautiful inside as you are on the outside, my dear.
Right.
That one talks a lot.
pouring it on. So on a 7 and 9, they need something more. Evidence that this is the right course, guidance in making the right choices, or resources to aid them before they act. The GM tells you what they need. So Feng Ma is like puts their hand on yours, not the bag of coins. Like you're holding the bag of coins, and they cup your hand in both of theirs, and is like, Quan, darling, we've been through so much together over the years. You know that I would do anything for you, but this isn't like you. Every time we see each other, it's always... well, to pardon the use of the phrase, a delight. But no amount of coin is going to change what I see behind your eyes. You know I would do anything to help an old friend. But I need to know what I'm getting myself into. I am not in a daring adventuring type like you are.
You may want to sit down for this one and pour yourself some of that tea.
Feng Ma pulls up a stool and pours the cup. Right, you wait, right? So very deliberately is like, oh, yes. Like, thought, like, maybe this is a some kind of situation, right? But clearly is like seeing the gravity in your voice and your eyes. And sits down and takes a sip.
And now, once we tell you what is happening, there's no turning back from this knowledge. Are you sure you want to know? Sometimes being ignorant of the facts can be, well, helpful for one.
Jen folds his arms. He doesn't like that statement.
Yeah, does that make John feel?
Like, that's the entire problem I'm facing here, is everyone's just going, oh, what I don't know can't hurt me, and they're wrong, they're all wrong.
Yeah, it's not good. I think Feng Ma, like, thinks long and hard about it. There's, like, an awkward, like, 3 seconds of silence. And is
Quan
like,
is patient, sips the tea, waits for an answer.
There's a tense moment. Like, it's a wide angle shot of the two of you, like, side by side, shot in profile with Chi and Jian sort of like waiting by the sides, right? As the two of you like eye each other and think. And finally, Feng Ma is like, friends trust each other. And you and I, Quan, we're friends. You've helped me when I've had my problems. I suppose it's only right that I should help you with yours, no matter what it is, because friends are always there for each other. They are shifting your balance towards trust. Do you want to take that? Or do you want to resist their words in this moment? I don't know why you would, but...
No, I'll take it.
So go ahead and shift your balance towards trust. So now you have +1 in trust and -1 in self-reliance as your sort of your perspective shifts. And so they're like,
what
tell me.
What is that on my sheet? Is he balanced?
On this
I think
sheet,
I'm like, you're centered, right? And then
it's right.
Yeah, do I just do plus one on balance or center?
You want to go balance goes over to towards trust.
Okay.
Yeah. And your center stays at zero.
Okay, cool. Yeah. Perfect.
So you should have plus one trust, minus one self-reliance. Yeah.
So she is waiting for me to tell her.
Yes.
What's going on.
It's like, oh, go ahead and tell me your story. Yeah.
She takes a sip, a final sip, and then a breath, and Quan will say,
it appears there's something else going on in our dear city here. Something nefarious. We found out today that Li Zhang has been giving some strange tea to our villagers here.
The Minister of Morale?
Yes, the Minister of Morale, which appears to be having some strange side effect on all of the people. She here almost drank it themselves. But we were able to stop him before he took his first sip.
Which I'm quite grateful for, by the way.
And this tea, it changes? It, what is it?
That is what we need to figure out. But perhaps you can help us in our endeavors. Tell others not to drink the tea. There's something else happening.
And Quan will look at Jean for this one.
Do you... I don't even know what to expect. Do you know what's going on outside the city?
I don't think anyone does.
Some people act like they kind of know, but they pretend they don't, and some people don't seem to know at all.
I know that sometimes it's very difficult for me to get shipments. The world is full of hustle and bustle these days, you know.
I don't know. The Fire Nation, do you know what they're up to?
Well, I know they think they're very big for their britches.
Quan shakes her head and looks downward.
We're at war. They've been fighting us for years.
I beg your pardon. Feng Ma puts the cup down. It's like, really, Quan? I help you with all kinds of people, but I wouldn't expect you to be trucking with people who are spouting nonsense.
This is what I'm talking about.
Shame, and then kind of like looks up and says,
he tells the truth. That's why I'm telling you. That's why I asked you to take a seat for this one. It's quite a bit to process.
It's not lies. I've seen it. I've
look at him. He's a soldier. Look at his garb.
We've had soldiers in peacetime as well. There is always a need for soldiers, especially in the Earth Kingdom. The king can only do so much, and the local provinces, and there is...
But why do you think they need soldiers? To fight in wars, to keep people safe.
They burned my village. They came in big... iron ships. I don't even know how you make them, how they float, but they came. And they destroyed everything, and I don't understand this. My entire life, I grew up knowing about the war. It's been going for nearly a century. And I get to the city and nobody even knows that it's a thing, and then you're all acting like I'm mad. I've seen them. I while I was still in my village. I heard about them breaching the wall here and then getting pushed back again, and I come here and no one even knows. Everyone's like, oh, our walls will stand against anything. They've fallen once.
Gwen puts her hand on John's shoulder and is like,
calm down now. It's not like my friend here is the one who did this to your village, but I understand.
I know, I just... When I came here, I thought everyone would be ready to fight.
Well, now we know why people are ready to fight.
Fengma, like, it just seemed so completely overwhelmed by everything. And looks sort of at John, and then looks to Quan, and in this sort of like, right? Like, if I admit this, then I've been, I just haven't seen what's happening in front of me, you know, in a way. Like, I can't reckon with this. And like, just sort of looks off in the distance. There was smoke that day on the far side, but it was farmers burning crops to clear the fields. How was the wall? Could they have? And like looks just like so forlornly at Quan.
Quan
and
is like
still
hand
in,
down,
you know, hands in hands. It's like
shame.
It's not is it true?
And then she looks back up and says,
I have to believe so. I don't want it to be true either.
It's not about what we want to be true, it's about what is true.
And so now it is about what we're going to do to help. Right?
Yes. It's about what we're going to do. Young man, I am so sorry for what happened to you and your people. You have to understand. In the city, this is the perfect place. A place where everyone can make their way. They tell us that things are well, and that Basingse is a hub of culture, of learning and art. And science, all of these things, the university, they study things all day, the treatises, the poetry houses are full of beautiful, beautiful words. The gardens, the posters, the signs, even Li Zheng. I've been to these parties, lavish affairs to celebrate the work that we are doing here. And you're telling me it's all a lie.
I don't understand why it is this way, but I know that it is. I've seen the soldiers. I've seen what they do. I don't know why we're pretending in here that it's all gonna be okay, because I think pretending it's okay is what... I could destroy the city.
Yes, you're right. If we hide from what's in front of our faces, no good could come of that.
And that is why we're here. We might have made a bit of a ruckus at Li Zheng's place, but it appears that the people were unfazed by it. At least those who drank the tea. Now they're looking for us.
My goodness.
I said they probably won't expect us to be here. I didn't expect to be here. Never seen this place before.
Well, you're in luck, young man. You're in Feng Ma's Textile Emporium, finest fabric shop in the lower ring. In all of Ba Sing Se, I dare say, although don't let anyone in the upper ring hear you say that. If you must know, a few of them do like to come slum it and purchase some of my finest wares. But they'll never let on.
I don't know who you're talking about.
Yeah, Fengma like kind of jabs an elbow in Quan's direction. They're sort of lightening up. And in this moment, if you're like kind of like, okay, we're getting going done, there are three heavy thumps on the door. Pump, pump, pump.
We need to hide. Where do we go? Just start looking around for like any hiding place, back
looking,
doors.
Right, desperately, right?
Yeah.
From the other side of the door, a voice says, Bossing say guard. Anyone home? Open up.
How did they find us? Gonna start.
I think we're gonna go hide.
Fengma's right? Just a moment, my dear. We're closed at the moment, but you've caught me at a bit of a bad time. Maybe if you'll give me just a moment. I don't care what time it is. We just have some questions. And you're looking around. So Gian, because you're panicking, I think, the most. Go ahead and assess the situation, is what it sounds like. Roll with your creativity. And do you don't have any conditions marked that affect that, right?
He is afraid.
I just have afraid marked.
Okay, yeah. Which makes sense.
Yeah.
Oh no, that's a 4. Ooh. To fail.
Ooh, okay.
Uh-oh.
So.
He just freezes up.
Assessing, you're like looking for things to do and hide, right? And on a miss, I get to make a move. What I'm gonna do is you're like looking for places to hide, and a familiar voice speaks through the door, like he's talking to somebody else, like to as an aside. Like,
you know these types. They don't respond unless somebody actually with authority on the ground tells them who's in charge. Listen up, urchin. I'm going to tell you just one more time. My name's Commander Run Ree of the City Guard. And if you don't open up this door in the next 5 seconds, we're going to make things very unpleasant for you.
You can find, like, there. Maybe you can hide upstairs. Maybe you can hide in the kitchenette. Maybe you can, like, look for something to throw yourself under in the fabric store, like, in the bolts of clothing. However you want to do it. But now you know that Commander Run Ree, who Gian has had some run-ins with before, is out there.
Yeah,
and Fengma is like up at the door, like pressed, like and turning back and looking at you with wide eyes, like, what do we do? What do I do?
Answer the door.
And then Quan will kind of motion for us to hide. We're gonna hide.
Before I leave the area, I'm going to grab the cups and the extra cups that were for us and just kind of like scoop it in.
Nice.
And just like boom, and just like roll tuck it to like a hiding spot or something where
yeah, so you're like pressed up against like behind the counter is what it sounds like,
or an open drawer or something that I can, I'm nimble enough, I can squeeze
with your back pressed. But you're like the kids in the Velociraptor scene in the kitchen in Jurassic Park. It's like okay, and Quan and Gian, you're like looking for some nearby hiding place, right?
Yeah.
After doing a terrible job of spotting anywhere to dive into, Jan's interrupted by that voice, and he kind of stops looking for hiding places. He like turns to the door and like clenches his fists, and it looks like he's like ready for a fight, though he does not look at all sure. But he's like,
So if it comes to it, right? I'm gonna right. But so Fengma
drag
answers
him into
the door.
A hiding place if she wants.
Fengma like creaks the door open, like, you know, wider than they did for you. It's like, ah, yes, good evening, officers. So sorry to keep you waiting. You know, I have just gone through my whole evening routine, you know, and it's a devil of a time trying to get everything sorted.
Yeah, that's great. Listen, we're looking for a group of unsavory types and running around causing a ruckus out here. Scruffy looking with a bunch of rags, more of a nicer dressed older lady, and a soldier, probably a deserter. You seen anyone looking like that?
Feng Ma's like, no, good evening. Goodness gracious, no. What do I look like? I'm a cloth merchant, sir. And frankly, I'm a little wounded that you would insinuate that I would debase myself with such rude company.
Well, then you won't mind if I look around for a minute, will you?
No, of course not. And Feng Ma, like, opens the door more fully. And behind the counter, you know, she hears bump, bump of boots as people start to walk in. Quan, where are you hiding?
I think there's it's not like a cupboard, but kind of like a cupboard that has, you know, like the brooms and stuff in it.
Mm-hmm.
And like, it's like me and I drag Jean in there with me. And then there's like a mop in the middle of us, like in front of our face.
Yeah, so it's like a cleaning cupboard.
Yeah, like a cleaning closet.
Yeah, so through the crack in this door, you see Commander Runri, right? I'm getting the impression this person's like a real tough customer, right?
Hmm. Yeah.
This is someone from your past, Jian, right? So
yeah.
What's the general vibe?
I think it's that kind of thing. Yeah, it's like very, very very into his own authority and using that and throwing his weight around and getting his way and maybe making judgments of people, at least he has in Jan's case.
Yeah. So he's, I think, this big burly guy, sort of like got a bulk to him, like stoic, you know, 5'10", big broad chest, thick arms, thick legs, heavy chest plate with like the lamellar kind of going down the sides, big bushy beard, and say like shaved head, right, which is right now covered by a helmet, but you can recognize his insignias and his beard and everything through everything. So he's walking around with a group of guards who are just sort of like the floorboards creak as they sort of methodically poke around, and they're like picking up bolts of cloth off the racks and on the sides. Like, oh, please, you can't. That's the finest silk. Do you know how long it took me to get all the creases out of that stuff?
I'm in charge here, all right? And I will tell you when I'm done investigating.
Feng Ma's like, yes, well. And they get closer and closer. Somebody leans against the counter and just presses his back against it and puts his hands on the counter and is like,
Commander, I think we're wasting our time here. This person doesn't seem to know anything.
And is like right on top of you, Chi. What do you do?
I hold my breath and try to just like close my eyes. I'm not here, right. Like just like try to squeeze myself into the cupboard as much as possible.
I think this moment is relying on your skills and training to remain hidden, because you're an outlaw. You're very good at hiding.
I'm very, very good.
You're very good at hiding. So go ahead and roll and add your focus.
All right. And then also reminder, the thing I did earlier, did it lessen Quan's fatigue by one, if I remember correctly?
I removed a condition.
Yes. Okay, you removed. Okay, all right.
I removed awesome. Insecure instead of fatigue. It didn't make sense for it to be fatigue for me. I think it made more sense that you were like consoling my insecurities about
just in case like punchy characters need help. Yeah, I'm just like, hey, do they have the punchy back? All right, let's do this.
Whoa, 12.
Nice.
Dang, you are so ninja.
Perfect.
It's like curled up in a little ball.
Yeah, you are so good at hiding. He's You're so used tiny. To like. Making yourself small and like maybe the because you're holding a bunch of cups.
He's got like he's got all the cups. Yeah.
Yeah, the cups and extra plates. Just like...
They like just start to crinkle a teeny bit, and I think you like reach out and grab like some loose cloth. Fangma was like cutting something earlier, and you just grab some of that cut fabric and wrap it around everything, so there's like a little clink, but you time it so that it's exactly when the scales on the armor leans back. It's like clink. And because you're so good at hiding, you don't even get seen when Commander Ranmuri walks right up to them, to the soldier, and like gets right. You can see him like breathing down the soldier's neck. He's like nose to nose with this person.
I'm sorry. Did you just tell me what I'm doing is a waste of time? Is that what I heard you say? My orders are a waste of time.
And the other soldier's like, oh, Commander, that's not what I meant.
You're slacking on the job here? You're not going to show some decorum to this fine merchant? You're not going to show some respect to someone who's hosting us here?
Commander, it's not what I...
I don't know what you thought, because it's clear that you don't think.
And grabs them by the like lapels of the armor and pulls them towards him.
It's like, when I give an order, you follow it. The only thing I should hear out of your mouth when I say jump is how high, sir. Am I understood?
Yes, sir. Yes, of course. Yes, sir.
Good.
Soldier snaps attention. Everyone else is just watching, like, I don't want to be this person. I'm not going to say anything. Everyone falls in line, and Commander Runry snaps his fingers, and everyone immediately like starts filing out, and he turns around.
Terribly sorry you had to see that. You know, good help is hard to find these days. Have a good night. Sorry to waste your time.
And he steps out and closes the door behind him. As the rest of you like heave a collective sigh of relief. And I think as you're getting your bearings after nearly being caught a second time, I think that's where we can probably take our break.
All right.
I was worried I was going to have to do something.
I was going to have to do something.
That's why I was checking before, like, hey, are the punchy people have enough?
I think I would have had something else that wouldn't have required punchy, but yeah, it could have gone to that for sure. Ooh. I'm like, I had one more thing up my sleeve if needed, but
it's just a good job you pulled Jan into the cupboard, because otherwise it would have been.
I just like the idea that you're just standing there and you're. Fists are clenched, and I'm just like, yoink! like
Arthur, the anime yoink. The yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah. All right, we'll head to a break. We'll be back in around about 8 minutes for the second half of the episode. We'll go grab a snack, and we'll see you soon.
Thank you. Thank you.
everyone, welcome back to Roll Fritz Avatar Legends RPG, Episode 1, Part 2. Let's get straight back to it.
Part 1 of Episode 1 was heavy.
Part 1B, after 1A. So we've just had our group of companions who are on the run from a conspiracy they've just uncovered, have been hiding out in a fabric shop, and they're catching their breath. And I think we don't need to see the immediate aftermath of that. I think what we learn is, like, Feng Ma, your tailor friend, is like, yeah, okay, I guess I'll help you. That makes sense. This is what friends do. We've helped each other out. Now that guards have come by and, like, been really pushy, like, listen, something's going on. There's people around. We're on edge. Feng Ma sort of understood the gravity of the situation and has agreed to put you up at least for the night.
Quan has been very grateful. Quan, from Jean and Chi's experience, is usually not a very, to put it word, nice person. Usually she's very, like, stern and direct. But I think that you've seen, like, a softer side of her in this whole scenario.
Yeah.
Jean's so gonna be very thankful as well, especially because he tried to get through to this person and it worked, and now they believe him and he appreciates that.
Yeah. This is the first person you've been able to connect with on the fact that there is a war going on, despite everyone else in the city thinking that everything's hunky-dory.
Yeah, I had to have him tell us that part of it. I was like, it doesn't make sense for my character to be the one telling that part.
It's so very.
Thank you for picking up on that, Bentham, when I was like, and I look at Jean. You tell the rest.
Jean's
of
like,
this.
Oh no. And then just went for it.
Yeah. So you have a night's rest. Obviously, this is a fabric store, but also, there's an apartment above where Feng Ma lives, and it's not exactly meant for more than one or two people living there tops. You know, it's a store in a cramped part of the lower ring of Ba Sing Se. So you've got, like, makeshift cots
cozy.
Rolled out. Yeah, you're very cozy. You're getting to know each other. It feels like a sleepover, except with more danger. And you're able to get some rest here overnight. I think everyone can clear up to 3 fatigue. I don't think anyone has more than 2 marked, because I don't think you marked any during that whole altercation. But having some rest, even if it's not the best rest you've ever had in your life, is like, okay, I can breathe, my muscles are still screaming, but I'm not panicking. Your conditions don't clear, and you still are feeling the way that you feel, but physically you're like, all right, I can go. In the morning, Feng Ma, like, helps you sort of get situated, but what do? Now that you've had some time to think.
I think Quan will also help Feng Ma, like, move stuff around, like, maybe like offer to carry, like, heavy stuff, because Quan is good at that. And we'll leave the planning to Jean and Chi to do.
Hey, Jean, what was up with that last night? You just froze. Do you want to talk about it or anything? You know,
it was that guy, the commander. His name's Ran Rui, and I met him before.
Now, he seems like a lovely individual. So lovely, lots of hearts and rainbows. I totally understand, but, like, I mean, like, are you? I don't know you to freeze, at least as far as I've seen you. Is that you're good, though? Is it just the stress of everything, or I'm just checking on you, man.
I don't know, if I didn't see a hiding spot, and when I thought he was going to come through the door, I was kind of ready to fight him. Probably wouldn't have gone well.
It worked out. You know, everybody's a little bit different. Like, have you ever seen Quad this nice before? Isn't it crazy? You think she, you know, did she drink some of the tea, you think?
I mean, I don't know much about Quan. I mean, you just met her too, right?
Just go ahead and let me. Everybody has their secrets, you know. I have mine. Quan has theirs, and you know, I've done in and out dealings here. This is like my first time actually really going in the city. We really do have to find a light, but like, you know what? If you're worried about hiding, like just rely on me, friend. I am most excellent at plans and everything. If you follow my lead, Jean. Yeah, I am the most excellent kind of person. If you need help, anything, just come to me. You know, I want you to really see me as like a mentor in many facts, you know, of the sneaking and the hiding.
It's like I'm really watching Bill and Ted. So you before, not to cut you off, but you were kind of like, hey, you want to talk about that? Are you okay? Bro, you good? I think you were trying to comfort or support Jian for a hot second there. So go ahead and roll with harmony.
I think Chi is like our support group member, like,
yeah, I the love
group
it.
Therapist. I was telling the chat,
would that be harmony or passion?
It's harmony,
but yeah, like but
intimidation,
okay.
Whereas, like, harmony is like, you know, the calm,
your ability to connect with other people,
yeah, keep people calm.
I do change if it seems that like Jean's not really comfortable with talk about it. That's why I was like, all right, change the subject, we got you. All right, let's go.
Nice.
Okay, you're so harmonious.
Oh my god.
On a hit, Jian has to decide if he opens up to you or not. If he does open up, you get to ask Jian a question, sort of related to this, like, are you okay, right? So it could be like, what are you worried about? Whatever it is. On a 10 plus, Jian can ask a question of you as well. So, Jian, do you open up about your feelings in this moment?
I think so. I think.
Okay. So, what's the question? What do you ask? Kind of on this train of thought of like, are you good? Right.
Like, I just want to, like, everybody has a past. You don't have to tell me, but like, if you need somebody to talk to, and also like, if we ever run into the when the odds are in our favor, like, do you should we jump that dude? Do we need a? I got you. On the scale of one to bad, like, how bad is, like, we should punch him in the face if we can?
I mean, I wouldn't mind punching him in the face. And so, what happened was when. I mean, I grew up out in a village in the middle of nowhere. You know, it was nice, but it's nothing like this. I always heard stories about Ba Sing Se and all this amazing stuff, huge palaces and the walls and more people than I could even imagine in one small place. But I mean, I don't know what I'm doing here. I had a plan. I was gonna come here. I was gonna tell them about the village, and I don't know. I guess they were gonna. I was gonna help him fight or something. And one of the first things I did when I got here was I went and found the army and tried to sign up. But, you know, I trained already. I had a commander. His name was Chen. He was the one who told me about the city. But I went to Commander Ren Rui and He said no. He didn't want me helping out. He didn't want me fighting with them. So now I don't know what I'm doing.
Hey.
Did you say
the truth?
Did you say Commander Chen, like C-H-E-N?
Yeah, that was his name.
Yeah.
Oh, okay.
That Quan raises an eyebrow.
I'm not there, so I don't actually know this, but that's interesting. People out there, remember that name.
I'm interested that that's interesting.
So because you answered that question honestly, you can clear a condition. And nice. Because Chi rolled a 10, she gets to, or you get to ask Chi a question in return.
You seem to know your way around this place. How to deal with people in a city, and how to move through a city and things. How do you learn all this?
I'll be honest with you. I have a very colorful past that, you know, not everybody would be like, nothing your grandmother would be proud of. Definitely. I know for sure that no, your grandmother would not be proud of this kind of life. And you know what? I always like urban city living's not necessarily for me. It's too many boxes, but I like to try to look at it as like a very square forest, you know, and all things are kind of the same, the terrain wise, but I, like I said, my colorful past, it had me dealing with some things here, and so I kind of learned the ways, and honestly, if, you know, just like, look at my face, look at how people, like, automatically see me just by looking at, you know, the very handsome, rugged person that I am, you kind of learn to work on your toes. Kind of thing. That's why I said, hey, me and you learn from me, and then maybe I could learn some of that, you know. And I kind of like very badly punch your armor, you know. We could learn from each other.
I think maybe we could.
I like this a lot. So because you answered as honestly as you can, I mean, you didn't say, hey, I'm sort of a criminal, but you're like, I have a colored ass, and that teaches you certain skills. I mean, you're saying in so many words.
Like, yeah.
Jen's picking up what she's putting down.
Yeah.
Well, he's putting down, but yeah.
Yeah, Chi. Yeah. Chi, so Chi, you get to clear a condition as well.
Ooh. Oh, yeah, we're all conditionless, I think, now, finally. Honestly.
Everyone's calmed down
like,
a little bit because you're talking
Simon
to
starts
each other.
Us off and he's like, two fatigue, one condition, go. Oh my god. All right.
Yeah.
I was very honest. What are you talking about?
You were
very,
very
honest.
Yeah.
Very honest.
This is so good.
So you've had this
like,
moment.
This is why
of
I had to leave them alone. I was like, I want this RP.
Yeah, you have the
selfish
bonding
RP.
That's great. Well, now that you've had this moment, I think Feng Ma like sets down a few things, like has been folding, like maybe you're finished putting up your futons for the evening, and putting them back, and just sort of like drops some folded clothing on a table, and it's like, well, I've done what I can. I don't know how much more help I can be, but surely there must be something to be done.
You've done a lot to help us, and we greatly appreciate it. Well, we have some things to do on our own here, but if you can try your best to spread the word to not drink the tea, that would be helpful. Not just for all of us here, but for the greater we.
I will do what I can.
And then Quan will look to the other two.
Are you ready? Do you have a plan? Perhaps we don't say it in front of my friend here. You know, the less they know, the safer they are.
Yes, I know all about plausible deniability. It's a very useful skill in a merchant, let me tell you. I'll just be going and opening up the shop now. And Feng Ma makes a very pointed, overdone bow. I bid you adieu. And steps downstairs and busies themselves with preparing for the day. Because you've woken up probably at the crack of dawn, and you're good to go. So you are left alone in Feng Ma's apartment. What do you do?
I don't really have a plan. I don't know where to start.
I think if we're dealing with medicine substances, yes. And I know a few people that have medicine links. And maybe I could try to talk with people who are in the pharmacy field that I know of.
out of character, could yes. I maybe assess the situation and get some answers to some questions before I create my personal plan?
Well, let's talk about what you're interested in figuring out.
Yeah. Basically, kind of, who's the actual threat here, right? Is it Li Zeng? Where is this tea coming from? Have I seen transports of maybe where this tea may have been coming from? Because that's kind of like what we're looking for, right? Is like, where is this tea coming from, right. And or where it's being created?
Okay, great. Some of that I can tell you flat out. Some of that we'll turn to the dice for. So the primary threat, out of game, we've established when you start to play Avatar Legends, there's a sort of session zero baked into the game rules. So we decide what our group goal is and sort of how things happen. And our group goal is to defeat a villain. So our villain is Li Zheng, the Minister of Morale. This is dangerous because this person is a government official and has a lot of backing. You can't just walk up and punch them until they stop doing what they're doing. So the big threat that you know of is Li Zheng, 100%, right? You know that Li Zheng is doing something to pacify people for some reason, probably to keep up the sort of the lie of there being no war. You also know that Li Zheng knows how to manipulate people using this specialty and was using some sort of not quite alchemical device, but it looked like a fancy, more complicated lab equipment by way of a coffee maker, you know, where you mix things in here and you brew the tea in this and you filter it through this thing and blah, 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 blah. And that's what Delight destroyed in the escape out of the tea house. So something, it's both this tea and this technology are involved.
Also, I want to make it clear to the viewers, it was destroyed, but by accident.
Yeah, this was not intentional. It was not sabotage. It was a casualty of general chaos. And in the process of all of that, Li Zheng and Li Zheng's guard were hey, you got to get out of here. What are you doing? You're sabotaging us. You're getting in on our secret. You're going to expose us. We're going to chase you out. And that's where we picked up the game, was you kind of hot on the trail of escaping. So yeah, your target is Li Zheng, if you're looking for someone to chase down after. You also know that Commander Ren Rui is involved just in general as an antagonist, but you don't know if there's any other connection there. As for the tea, I think that is where we can turn to rely on your skills and training, not necessarily assess the situation, because that's more about what's immediately around me, right? I think you're trying to gain some insight into a deeper question, which is where this stuff is coming from. And I think your urban plant, your urban background makes a lot of sense because you see a lot of stuff coming and going, right?
Yeah. So and mostly go ahead just following Delight around and watching for everything that's suspicious, which is everyone.
everything, right? Because you're a bodyguard. Everyone is a threat. You're doing the Jason Bourne thing. If you walk in a room, you know, those three people could kill me, and these are the exits that I can get into. So go ahead and roll with your focus.
Which, again, I didn't do very well because she was under the table by themselves. and I pulled John instead. Oh, my goodness. All right, here we go. And this will be with focus again?
It's focus, yep.
Which I'm, you know, not the greatest at, but we shall see. Failure. No.
Okay.
On a failure.
So on a miss, nothing specific happens, but I, as the GM, get to make a move. So you know, here's what you know. This tea is made from what Li Zheng described. We flash back to this moment, right? We go... you kind of zoom in on your face for a second as you're recalling this information. And we're in this fancy tea house, it's a tea house that's been booked for a private event, quote unquote, somewhere in the lower ring. And Li Zheng, this tall, rail thin, bolt upright person in, you know, Earth Nation finery, Kingdom finery, is in the process of brewing this tea and pouring these cups very methodically. And it's this tea that comes out this rich, deep red, this clear, deep red. And Li Zheng is explaining, the ruby jasmine, beautiful color, isn't it? I must say, it is a delight to the eyes as much as it is to the senses. Breathe it in. You smell that soothing aura. Ah, so calming. This is a staple of many things that Ba Zingze can provide to you. You outsiders who have traveled so far to come to our great city, you will be of the first to partake of our glorious bounty. Drink deep and let its calming water flow through you. That's it. And, you know, there's a stash of these dried jasmine leaves. So you know the plant, that's very distinct.
Ruby jasmine.
Okay. This ruby jasmine is, like, impossible to miss. It's this kind of rich gem red flowers with a very particular aroma. And I think you know where you can find some.
Okay. Where
you can find some.
Jasmine found.
There is a garden in the agrarian sector that the Chens have that grows all kinds of flowers. But you remember, from not too long ago, one of the people there was very proud of their recent acquisition, a cultivar of ruby jasmine. This is about a year ago, almost, at this point.
So there's like a new person who they've brought in who is a cultivar of that.
They got like seeds of it. It doesn't grow around here, but someone brought it in and is growing it there. and the complication that I'm introducing as a GM move here is that it's owned and operated by the Chen family, who are your employers.
Yes. That's why that name was so interesting to me, Bentham. But I didn't know that. So in character, my character says,
now you know.
As the two of you are like, I don't really have a plan, I'm not sure. She says,
well, I don't know necessarily where the tea is being made, but I do think I remember something important. When Li Zheng was telling you about the tea tree, they mentioned ruby jasmine, which I know the Chens have been growing in their garden. more recently. I really hope they're not part of this. That would be worrisome. What did that name sound? That is Delight's family. I have been a guardian of their family for many years. Her father, Song, and now Delight herself.
Well, speaking of which, we... Yeah, no, go ahead.
If they're growing it, then we just need to destroy it. If they can't get any, then they can't make the tea.
Well, that is much easier said than done, young one. The garden is protected. It is, well, in a section of the city that is not as easily traversed by.
And she kind of like points at the two of you. She doesn't like say it out straight out.
Implying.
And yes, for those out of character, Delight is Elf's character.
Mm-hmm.
Distracted Elf, who will be joining us next week.
Well, if you can get me in there, I'm sure I can do something about it.
We can certainly try.
Or we could figure out a way that, you know, if Delight is the part of the family that you work for, couldn't she just convince them otherwise? You do really want to find your ward, we should probably, you know, it's been whole
might
night.
Be the first part. If I return home without her, there might be some repercussions.
I feel like I could. I am very debonair. I just need you know, like what is all to being rich? Just nice clothes, right? Like bathing more than once a week. I could do that.
Well, there is some form of etiquette that you must adhere to when eating and drinking and conversing and walking and talking and such.
What if we just snuck into the garden at night? They're not going to guard a garden, right? It's just some plants.
It is not the garden. It is more what you need to get through before you get to the garden that is the concern. But you're right. First, we must find Light. And perhaps she can talk to her family, but I warn you, I don't think that it will go well. But she might be able to get a glint of information for us that will help us. I think we must be patient in our endeavors. You can't just go rolling in, destroying seeds. They'll just bring more seeds in.
But what makes people really worried? What if we start spreading rumors about that particular tea being a mutation happening and that it makes people violently diuretic?
That could be something.
Hmm?
I like the thinking of that. If you want to go spread some rumors, I don't see any harm in it.
That
what
could
do you
work.
Think, Sean?
That makes sense. If everyone's afraid of Ruby Jasmine, no one's going to drink any tea made of it.
Then they may just make a new tea. But we will have to deal with that. It will help us in the meantime.
Fight disinformation with your own.
I love it.
Well, it sounds like a plan. So how do you want to go about tackling this?
I think I'm going to be on the hunt to figure out signs of where Delight might be, whilst maybe
okay.
The two of them can get this story plotting.
So Chi and Jian, yeah, but you have it sounds like you have an idea of we're going to make some misinformation somehow. So there's a couple of steps involved in that and some things that you might need to get your hands on. What do you want to do and how do you want to do it?
So maybe we can just go around and tell people some stories about people getting poisoned by Ruby Jasmine, or I mean, we act it out. Maybe we act like we've been poisoned by Ruby Jasmine. I could draw attention, though.
Yes. I could draw attention. I feel like the best place we could go to is let's go to some tea shops around here and then maybe talk about stories, you know, because we are, of course, travelers, you know. But Quan, sure you're going to be okay, you know. Like, I also care for Delight as well. And, you know, maybe we could both look out for her at the same time.
That would be helpful. If you see signs, let me know. I will make my efforts focused on such.
The thing is, if she's smart, she's laying low. But if she's laying low, we can't find her. We can keep an eye out. You never know.
Okay. Well. I guess, Jean, would you like to take a tea date with me?
Sounds like a plan.
You link arm in arm and head out.
I will follow them, but I'm less watching out for them, other than maybe Chi. But I'm kind of, my efforts are more just kind of looking out for signs of maybe where Delight might be, or some signs that she might have left behind.
Right. You know. Did she drop something? Have people been talking about someone who resembles her? Right.
Yeah.
Cool. So you're going to some tea shops and you're going to make a scene, right? So
too much of a scene. I think we're going to spread it in different ways, if you don't mind me.
I'm just getting clarity on what your plan of attack is.
So the first story is that I'm coming to, like, let's go to a lower end tea shop. Mm-hmm. And then make fun of, like, shh. I'll be, like, talking to Jean in a very loud whisper voice. Did you hear about those nobles from XYZ City? Let's call it Jasmine City.
Yeah. They tried making tea out of Ruby Jasmine, of all things, and then it was just a mess. They were so ill.
I heard it's so funny. You would have been my servant friends in that quarter. It would be so nice to see how those nobility struck down, because, you know, they just, all of their decorum just went out the window. Like, hey, hey. And then I'll, like, did you hear about this story? It's hilarious. I heard that the General Tai just out of nowhere, after drinking this, like, what would you call it? What would you do? Ruby,
Jasmine. Yeah, that was the
Ruby
was
Jasmine the tea. I heard that strong, you know, General Tai, he's a very strong, willed man. And then just suddenly his face went all pale and a foul smell filled the whole entire room. It was great. Can you imagine General Tai? Look at these nobles getting into things that they know. Everybody knows that, like, that Red Ruby Jasmine's not good for your health. It just makes, you know, it keeps the sheep regular and the cows regular, if you know what I mean. But
so you're just, like, in a tea house and just going with this story, right? Very loudly and pointedly.
Like, it's a funny story. Come on, this is a lower-end society. We get to make fun of nobility when they...
Right, you're in the lower ring, right? And so a few people are kind of like looking over. There's at least like one or two couples here who are sort of like, oh my god, every time we go out, this happens. There's just someone who has to be the main character and is just going off on these things. And, you know, people used to have some respect for other people's privacy and other people in these public spaces. Like, there's a few people who are like sniping at you. And then there's a few, I think there's a couple of laborers who are on break. Like, they're people who do like heavy lifting around here, like construction. They're construction workers. So there's a mixture of people who like do regular stuff and also earthbenders. So they're covered in dust and their clothes are just like, you know, cut sleeves, short pants and everything. Who are like, hey,
sorry, what were you talking about? I heard you saying something about General Ty. I heard that guy's a total type one. This I gotta hear. So hang on.
And he waves over someone over at the counter and is like, hey, another refill for my new friends here, and puts down a couple of coins. Like, oh, so you were, I'm sorry, pal, you were saying, what were you saying? I gotta hear this story again.
You know, this thing, the jasmine ruby tea, just don't drink it. You know, it's just, I don't know what these nobles are thinking, but you know, like our nan would say, like, you know, certain plants help good digestion, and these people have it in their idea that they should just drink it up, and then surprise, surprise, what happens? Ooh, so I would avoid it if anything, you know. Maybe we just avoid it.
We went right through him, and it just, like, a complete embarrassment in front of his troops. It's hilarious.
It sounds like you're trying to trick this NPC into believing this complete and bold-faced lie. Go ahead and roll with your creativity, Chi.
All right. Let's hope for the best.
Hey, ooh, not bad.
Ooh. Mixed success.
I'd like to take a fatigue to give
a plus one to that.
Yeah. And I think we established you're selling it. You already did your, like, oh my God, can you believe? You're just really going along with it. I think too, because it didn't seem like she had talked about this plan beforehand. You're just like, oh yeah, and you're riffing.
Totally. Right? Yep, no, this freestyling the general on it. Tie. Yep, no, he was a complete mess.
Great. So it's a 10 plus, which means Chi, you get to pick two options from the list. They're going to fall for it and do what you want in the moment, which is they're going to, like, believe this and tell their friends. Do you want them to stumble and give you plus one to your next roll targeting them? Act foolishly, and I will tell you what additional opportunity they give you. Or overcommit, and they're deceived for a while.
Overcommit. I would choose for the overcommitting, so it gets to spread at least, like, in the lower quarters, and then, like, as it goes up in tiers, maybe the whispers go up, you know? Because it's funny, if we try to keep it from the nobles, and then the nobles would want to know, and then be like, oh, if it's the lower class that knows of what this actually does, this is what she is thinking.
Right. The pyramid. And what's the second thing that you want to have happen?
So believing in a longer term. And I guess a plus would also help for, like, later on purposes.
So it'll be, like, on the next thing that you do targeting this person. So it'll kind of be within this scene, basically. Or you can take an additional opportunity. So you want the plus one. Okay.
Yeah.
So this person, this guy, is like, he did what? Oh, he cleared himself out. Oh my gosh.
Quite foul.
Hey, get over here. And he, like, yells out the front door of the tea shop, like, gets up and pokes his head out, like, hey, Bo, Ty, you gotta come over here. Hey, listen, I got a story for you. And he sits everyone down and he's like, okay, tell it to him just like you told me, right? And has you go through the whole thing again and again. And every time you get to something that you've already established, he, like, roars with laughter, like, it's even better the second time. I love these guys. And they like, he buys into it. Like, he's yelling at the tea shop owner, like, hey, you don't have any of this stuff, do you? That's not what you're serving us, right? Because I know your tea's not good, but it's not that bad. I'll tell you that. And you water this stuff down. Don't lie to me. Come on. Everybody waters it down. It's cheaper that way. This guy waters the tea down. Can you believe it? A bunch of rinky-dink tea shop. It's all hard to get these days. But, I mean, who cares? It keeps you going on the long day. Hey! And so he's just going for it. And he finally turns back to you. And he's like, you know, I like you, pal. Listen. What'd you say your name was?
I'll go ahead and say it. Well, G.
Chi. All right, listen up, everybody. Chi's a good guy. Chi's a good person. All right? I know quality when I see it. And Chi's quality. So, but tell me, friend,
How did you even get a handle of this stuff? I mean, I never heard of this red jasmine stuff before anyway. This is some hoity-toity new thing? Is it, where's it coming from? What's the story here?
Well, from my understanding, it's the new fangled thing, like maybe came in some time ago. I don't know. It's been making its circuits. It's not really like well known here. I am just newly like coming into the city. That's why I have such great stories to tell, because you know, they're not gonna let me just like tell it in the actual city that General Ty lives in, you know. Oof. But yeah, it's just, I feel like it's a very fairly new thing. You know, all these, like, when something new comes around with these nobles, they're all like, ooh, give me, without actually knowing what it does to them. But yeah, it was like, oh, what was your name? And I'll just have my hand out.
You're ready to shake.
Yeah. Ready to shake.
It's Yang.
Yang. Give him a big old, like, arm, solid arm
shake. Yep. The yeah. Clasped arms. Yeah, good. Oh, so you're from outside. You know, we got a lot of new people coming in here. There's a whole bunch of stuff. You know, it's people that every day they say, oh, we're going to come and make a better life in Ba Sing Se. But I mean, look around you. You get what you pay for. Am I right?
Yeah, you get what you pay for. But, you know, I want you to remember my name, because one of these days, I'm going to be in the upper rings, you know? I have those dreams.
You're going to be in the upper ring. Hey, you hear what he said? You hear what they said? They're going to be in the upper ring. Come on now, kid. Listen, I know you're a good storyteller, but you're not that good. What makes you so sure you're going to be up there with the Richie Riches?
Because I got ideas, friends. I know when tea is bad, and so I know how to corner that market to know not to invest in that stuff. You know? And then, I got things. Even I got my, like, friend here. We got even know-how for, like, outside military stuff. It's just by, like, you know, armor-wise, like, it's not about muscle sometimes. It's about what's up in there.
And that's, so he's, this guy's like, yeah. Oh, she's got ideas. She's got ideas. You hear that? Well, ideas, you know, I hope those ideas are paved in gold, because I don't know how else you're going to get up there. And then you say, we've got military expertise, and Yang turns and lays a big, hairy, meaty arm on John's shoulder. Goes, hey, soldier boy, hey, look at you. Yeah, you must have some stories. You know, there's not much going on right now, I'm sure, but come on, you must be itching to get in some action, huh? Right? They must be training you up good, huh?
It's coming along. I'm learning.
Hey, show me some moves, huh? Show me some moves. Show me, what are they teaching you? Come on. You know, I got a little bit of skill myself, you know. I got the 1-2 jab and they don't see it coming.
I can show you some moves. I can do that. And it's like a little nervous up till now. Jen's like, "Oh, this is, I know this. I can show moves. I've trained." And so he's going to stand up and start kind of like performing some of the various like stances and the like attack moves and defense moves that he's been trained in and all that kind of thing.
So you're like going through some katas, right, and stuff, and everyone's like, "Whoa, whoa, whoa!" Yeah,
there's lots of like people. Punches and blocks and
right. And he's like, "No, not like that! I want to show you." And he like starts pushing you outside, and he's like, "Hey, come on, show me!" And so he's in the street. In this busy lower ring street, Yang is like, "Hey, yeah, show me! Come on, show me some moves. I want to see what you got. I want to show you, see what you got." What do you do?
I'll try and put on a performance. I'll probably throw some earthbending in as well. Like now we're outside and it's a little bit safer. And earthbending seems to be just a normal thing you can do in the streets anyway.
Like a mock fight, right?
Yeah, he's gonna like start kicking up blocks, but then he'll just like put them back down again and stuff like that.
Yeah. Go ahead and rely on your skills and training, I think is what you're doing here. This is a roll with focus.
Oh, that's a miss. Three.
Okay.
Oh no.
So you're a soldier, right?
I remember that my focus is minus one, and I'm like, oh, I know where this is going.
Oh no.
And here's what's happening here.
It's like the expectation versus reality.
The reality, right? You, as you said in our kind of like pre-session, your fighting style is like you're a line soldier, right? You're good at working in a unit, in a formation. Mm. But not so much out of that, right?
Yep.
So I think it's hard for you to kind of perfectly get your moves in without, you're used to synergizing. Like, we're all going to work to lift this big boulder and then shove it at someone, like a cannon.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, all of that stuff.
All like the team efforts of like, however many people we have, that's how much we lift kind of deal.
Right. And I think like you're doing a pretty good job of holding your own more or less, but it's not perfect. And I think Yang gets like a swing in on you, like hits a throat, like scatters a couple of pebbles across your face. And instinctively you're like, huh. And you swing back and you knock him kind of into some crates outside the tea house. And he gets up and he's like, hey, hey, that's what I'm talking about. He's having a great time.
Sorry, I didn't.
No. And he's like, he's great. He's fine. And he's dusting himself off and he's shaking your hand and everything. He's like really chew into this. And that's when a group of guards, are like, hey, you see that over there? What the? And they walk over. And a group of five of these guards, like a five to six guards, are like, hey, break that up, you two. There's no fighting in the streets. What are you doing?
Oh, sorry. We were just practicing. It's fine. We're friends. We're good. And I like,
right. We're cool. It's cool. And they're like, I don't care if you're best buddies or if you're siblings. There's no fighting in the streets. Civil disobedience. And you, and the lead guard jabs a finger at Gian. It's like looking kind of you up and down because you're still in most of your uniform. Where's the rest of your kit?
I lost it.
You lost it? He like incredulously looks over to the rest of the guards and mouths it. He lost it? How?
Oh man, I'll go ahead and bump into this and be like, man, that was such a throwing party last night. I'm glad that we were able to give you one more last night of freedom before you had to head out and stuff. And you know, hey, hello. And then I like whatever the army signal is for that.
You do a little salute. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh what, yeah, yeah. Just gotta go find my gear wherever I left it last night, and I'll be good to go. Yeah.
Gee, it sounds like you're trying to trick these guards into leaving you alone. Go ahead and roll with your creativity.
Oh boy. Alright, let's do this. Hopefully it's great. Ah!
Okay, can I once again take a fatigue to
take a fatigue to sell it?
How about, can I take a fatigue myself so you're not fully like, or
no, whoever's helping you has to take the fatigue because they're putting in the effort. Yeah. Okay, so you've got the fatigue mark.
This makes sense for Jan. He's way out of his depth here, so like he's trying to keep up with this whole city way of dealing with problems, mm-hmm. and it's stressing him out. But he's holding on.
I think you're selling the illusion, right? Because you know how to talk to soldiers, you know like all the right things to say, and you're playing along with this. Like, oh yeah, we got totally trashed last night, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah, it was this. I read Jasmine, you know.
Right. Like, you sneak it in there, right? You're like, you heard of this stuff, red jasmine? It's really going to mess you up.
I like that it's going to change from ruby to red jasmine.
Right. Oh, so, yeah, ruby jasmine.
Ruby jasmine.
Same difference. So,
call it red, it's fine.
Gee, what two options do you want from the list? I assume they are deceived for some time.
Deceived for some time, and then just in case, I will take that, like, I guess what you said, opportunity? You said that was another thing I could...
Yes, they act foolishly, and I will tell you what additional foolishly opportunity to give you.
Foolishly. We'll go with the foolish, because, you know, they've been a young guard before. Their first, like, right before they go out. Maybe they, like, oh, thank you. Like,
right.
I'm a good, yeah.
So, I think that they buy it, first of all. Hook, line, and sinker. Mm-hmm. The officer, the sergeant, in charge is like looks you up and down, I think, like, forcibly readjusts your uniform, Gian, is like, all right, look, if you're gonna, at least gonna walk around halfway in your civvies, like, have the decency to make the rest of us look good. What? I don't care what you drank last night. You find that armor, you make sure that it's ship shape for the inspection. Last thing I need is Ron Rory breathing down my neck again about how everyone's not in garb and not looking right. The opportunity that I think you get is you're looking for information about this stuff, and you're also looking for ways to, like, spread in disinformation.
Mm-hmm.
So I think while they're busy dealing with Gian, they're totally bought into Gian, like, listen, don't screw it up, okay? They're not paying any attention to you, and you're able to kind of take in your surroundings. While you're thinking about everything, the opportunity I think you get is you notice, like, across the way, there's a printing house. They make prints, you know, they've got a press and everything. There's a vendor who's selling some wares of some prints that they've made, sort of like ukiyo-e style, like, here's all this stuff, but probably has materials to make flyers and stuff that you could mass produce. So you're like, listen, what, how are we gonna sell this lie? Oh, there's something over there. And they like, as you're sort of taking all that in, the sergeant finishes sort of dusting off Gian and is like, all right, listen, I'm not gonna report you to your superior officer because we've all been there, okay? Everybody gets one, though. All right, that was your one.
Oh,
and
yeah,
walks
yeah,
off.
That's it. I won't do anything again.
And Yang is like doing the sort of like, whoa, somebody's in trouble. I wouldn't want to be you right now. And he goes back into the tea house and he's like, ah, you kids, right? What do you do? As you're sort of left alone momentarily.
Thanks for saving me there. I don't know what I was going to say otherwise. I mean, I can't just tell him I lost it. Fighting
I find
the Fire
that
Nation.
Wait, what?
What?
Wait, that's I thought you just like
my armor. I.
Oh, so you
at,
just?
At the village,
I thought it happened a long time ago, and you were talking. I thought you just lost in transit. You just went straight. Wow, I did not know that. Wow. Okay, so that, yeah. Oh. Well, now I know more. Your family's good. That if you just
they're okay. They're safe. They're
okay. Well, you know, I generally, for future notice, if you pretend that you just got really drunk, I feel like a lot of people forgives a lot of things. You don't have to actually drink. But just
it
like
it
people
does seem like
understand.
It works, yeah.
Yeah. So usually when I find myself in trouble, most of the time, 70% of the time, if you just pretend you're a drunker, you get out of a lot of things.
Yeah. I'm not used to it. Usually the truth would just work before.
I mean, I like to say these are just spicy truths, because eventually I will be like this. So it's like a future truth, you know?
Huh.
Spicy truth, future truth. Like, eventually, if you at least become drunk later on, then it will be the truth. You just did a future truth of yourself. You know what I mean? Yeah, you know what I mean. Yeah, it's pretty.
Just shakes
his You're just
head
trying like, to process the train of thought.
All right, whatever.
Well.
If it works, it works. I'm not going to question it.
I don't know how many coins you have on yourself, but I noticed a little thing that might be easier than going to each of these tea houses, because I don't know how much tea you can drink. But I just kind of like make a like a gesture to the printing press.
Oh. This is like new for Jan. I don't think they'd have this in his village. He's like, wow, they could just like make a bunch of like posters?
I feel like, let me see. Let me see.
John's over there, like, drawing everyone on his own.
like, patting coins down. Susu, do you have the money pouch?
A little blue and white stoat wriggles out of your tunic with a pouch in its mouth.
Ah, thank you, Susu.
What? There
you go. Oh, pat a little, like, maybe I have a little extra biscuit I swipe from the tea house, and I...
Yeah.
Been in there the whole time?
What, do you not keep a stout in your stout pouch?
No.
Everyone should have a stout in their pouch.
Susu, like, scrambles up onto your shoulder and, like, starts sniffing at Jian.
I mean, it's kind of, like, always been on me. I've had it since I was a little baby. It's kind of hard to not have it on me, you know? Susu, this is Jian. Jian, Susu.
Is he friendly?
Yeah!
I warily put out a hand.
Susu warily puts out a paw. So this tiny paw like reaches out and touches
like
your
that
finger.
Painting with the fingers.
It's right. It's like the creation, Adam and God's finger. This one little paw.
It's not what Jean was expecting. So he like shakes the paw.
Susu kind of like turns their head a little bit, like, and then kind of scampers up your arm. And then kind of like climbs over your head and then back around your shoulder.
Ah, it's kind of cool to the touch, right? That's a ice or a frost stout. Kind of cooling.
Huh. Cool. Literally.
But yeah, so I think the only you know army talk, right? How do we make this sound official if you were going to be like, warning, this thing makes you poop your pants out? I feel like that a lot of people can get behind not pooping themselves. I feel like, unless you think there's a bitter one, I don't know. What's universally like not good to have?
I could make something like that work. I think that makes sense.
All right. Well, yes, I think we have enough coins for maybe, like, not a lot of flyers, but we could start putting it out. Make it look kind of official-like. Very official-like, yes.
Yeah, an announcement from...
The Health Bureau? Do they have a Health Bureau? I don't know.
I guess the Ministry of Health. There's got to be a thing, right?
Yeah. Oh, darn, I wish Quan was here. Quan knows all of this kind of stuff, I guess.
an announcement from the Ministry of Health about the dangers of Ruby Jasmine.
Yes, I like your thinking.
And if you boil it, then it is bad for your digestion.
Yes, very bad for your digestion.
We'll work out the finer points when we make them.
Sounds that's a solid plan, and we'll print a few, and then maybe we'll go ahead and see if it sounds right to Quan before we start. Well, I bet in the lower echelons we could probably space it, but maybe if we have to print more, we could. You know.
Maybe we could even have like a drawing on the thing of like what the leaf looks like or something.
What did the leaf look like? I mean, I knew what the finished product looked like, but I don't. Maybe I could make it in the teacup, but then it just looked like a jar
of. Maybe that
blood.
Won't work then. I don't know. Maybe if we put a cup
a
of tea.
Drawing roll to see how well.
We'll both do a drawing roll to see if we can figure out.
And maybe if we draw a cup of tea, that'll make people think of it when they see the cups of tea.
Ah.
And then they might think twice about drinking it. Even if.
Bentham, this is the origin of the leaf from our Warhammer campaign.
The leaf.
It's Li Zheng giving it to them. They might be like, oh, I saw a flyer about that. I don't know. That's not a good idea. I should go home. Maybe.
Mm-hmm.
Wisdom. So you're having this chat as you're like on the approach towards this print shop. Quan, you've kind of been like nearby, but you're talking to people, right? And about looking for Delight. I think eventually you get in contact because the Chens have people kind of all over the city. They're pretty influential. I think eventually you get in contact with like a runner. I think the Chens have messengers that sort of just jump around the city like tressiors, like parkour, not bike messengers but on foot, up to a certain point, because the city is huge. It would take you like 2 days to walk from one side to the other, but certainly within different areas. I think you manage to flag someone down who has heard. Delight managed to make her way back to the Chen compound in the upper ring, so she's fine. She's also like grounded, basically. She didn't come home. She missed some stuff. There was supposed to be like a family event, like maybe a dinner, and she was out all night and was caught sneaking into the compound. And Song, her father, and your former retainer, the person you used to guard, is like, young Missy, you're gonna sit here while you learn some responsibility.
All right, cool. I will thank the messenger and tell them I have some more business to do in the city, and I shall return.
Okay. So you start moving to catch up to everyone else. So you'll be kind of like just behind them, more or less. Like, not quite there, but on the way in. Inside the print shop, there is this whole time we've been talking, this woman's been kind of moving in and out of the shop and hanging things up. She's been putting her wares up and kind of like adjusting things. She's clearly like the person on site. When you come in and you see that she's busy kind of like arranging things and just generally like hustling and bustling. So she's darker brown skin, green eyes, hair pulled tight back. Actually, it's cropped short. It's like cropped very short, like a bob. She sort of looks up from a stack of papers that she's organizing, of prints. I'll be right with you. Sorry, I just, it's a lot to get done and not a lot of hands. Carrying like armfuls of prints kind of over to a bench.
if it looks like it's too much to hold, I'll offer to help a little bit. Like, you know, hey, let me, tell me where to put this.
Oh yeah, you go over and you're like, oh, hey, let me help. And she looks at you like, oh, thank you. Hi.
Anything for a pretty lady. And
she like gasps a little bit, like, oh, thanks. Anything, I always take help from a handsome helper. And like she turns away, and you, like, you hear her muttering under her breath, handsome helper, why did I say that? What am I, what? puts some of the papers down, and turns back and tries to play it cool, like one hand on the table, the hand slips against the papers, like, so what can I do for you?
Well, as you can see, I'm kind of here on official business, as I flag to my two soldiers. Are they both here? Are Quan
and Jian? Jian's here. I think Quan like enters like as you're gesturing.
Yeah,
definitely. So with my one, point, two.
As you point two. Behind, I'm definitely like poking at like at some like device, like some printing press element with like metal bits and springs, and something like goes proing. He's like, oh,
right, it goes flying backwards. And she's like, soldier, and she the spring goes flying, and she whips back. Quan, oh, don't touch spring. That.
So I didn't mean to. It's fine. I'm sure it's fine.
And I just don't want you to. You're gonna crush a finger if you do that. It's very sensitive. Sorry, and she goes over and grabs the spring, and she's like trying to push it in into the machine, like readjust it. It's just a lot of things. And
it's like, you know, when your chain falls off the bike all the time and you have to like re-put it back on.
Right, exactly. Like, oh, this thing again.
That one spring.
Oh, what is the military though? What do you?
Oh, no. Just very official things. Like, I heard. Have you heard about this? The new health from the health department coming out. We have to make flyers to warn the public about this new type of tea that's been going out and brewing called Ruby Jasmine. Apparently it's been making a lot of people outside the city very sick. To say a most undignified, you know, loosening of the bowels. That's what it does.
Oh, she like hand over mouth, like we don't talk about this in polite company. Oh my goodness, I hadn't heard anything about anything like that. It's from the Department of Health, and nobody. I hadn't heard anything.
Yeah. When you say that, I will use my badge of authority to assist with this.
Oh,
if I can.
Well, what do you, so your badge of authority, you have a symbol or a badge that shows some kind of authority that people listen to or respect. Even if they don't like you, you are someone to be listened to. So what this move lets you do is give someone an order based on that authority and their recognition of it to get them to do something. So you can flash the badge for sure.
Yeah.
And then do you want to tell her to do something based on that?
Yeah. To kind of like back up Quan's like,
yes. And she holds up the badge and she's like, we're here on important business. We need to get this message out as quickly as possible.
From House Chen. Oh my goodness. I didn't realize that you were, wow. I didn't think you did any work in the health department, but she's like trying to piece it together. Like, she knows the Chens are important.
Yeah.
They are like high ranking government officials. They've got positions in government. They've also been doing work in the military occasionally. They've been branching out. So she's trying to parse this. Go ahead and roll with your passion.
Okay. There's like two dice here, I'm not really sure. There's a left dice and a right dice. Does it matter which one I hit?
I don't know.
Ooh, can I aid with the fatigue to make that a complete success?
A 10? You could.
Yeah.
How would you sell this command?
Like just saying that yeah, they usually, of course, they usually don't deal with this kind of health department biz, but they were trying to find a different use for this tea to age soldiers in the field. So it is part of the research they were doing. And then they discovered the adverse effects. So that's how it all ties. Like basically making it make sense of why they would. Yeah.
Oh my goodness. That's, you know, all of this stuff is completely out of my, I'm an artist, not a herbalist. But if the Chens, if it comes down from the Chens, then of course, anything to help the family that's done so much for Ba Sing Se, it's going to take time.
Perhaps you can stop rambling on and use your artistry to write this up. Come on, snip snap.
Yes, miss. Well, I'll need some information. I'll need to know what you want the message to say and any other official business and things like that. So she starts like pulls out a pad and a tablet, and she's starting to like take notes. And as she's like going about like trying to busy herself, the shop door swings open. And I don't think we established anything about this door, but I think there's a bell on it for fun. And the bell jingles, and she looks up, and her face goes pale. And a couple of people kind of crowd their way in, some rough-looking types, led by, let's say, another woman who has some scarring on her face, hair kind of cut like a side-shaved hawk, so like the top hair is there and then sort of pulled back into a ponytail, and some toughs, like some street toughs with her. And she leans up against a pole on the side in the room and says, Willow, I hate to interrupt you when you're in the middle dealing with some customers, but you're late. And she wiggles her fingers to gesture coin. And Willow, the printmaker, like puts the tablet down and like, yes, I know, I'm sorry. Would you excuse me? I need to and starts kind of rummaging under the
Yeah, I think Quan is like super suspicious of what's going on here. I do have an ability called Suspicious Mind. It's like when you watch a person carefully to figure them out, I can roll focus and I can kind of like assess the situation kind of to some extent.
Yeah. So go ahead and roll with your focus.
Oh, fail. Oof. I don't assess it. Four. I'm just like, I step away. When he asked that, then Quan says to Jean,
perhaps they have some business. We should stay out of it.
And kind of steps back.
So on a miss, you tip your hand, but you can shift your balance away from center to ask a question from the list. So do you want to shift your balance?
Back to zero. Okay.
It's away from center. So it'll go in the direction it was already moving. So because your balance went towards trust.
Yeah.
You'll go a step towards trust again.
Oh, interesting.
Because it's away from center rather than like towards center.
Okay, so I could still ask a question.
Yep. You'll go at to +2 trust, -2 self-reliance. But you'll get to ask a question.
Okay, and the -2 self-reliance would go to, where do I put that? Oh, that's just part of the process.
It's just part of it. So wherever your balance track goes, then you'll have +2 to the principle that you're shifting in the direction towards, and it'll be -2 in the opposite direction. It's always the same value,
Oh, okay.
Just in opposite ends.
Okay. Then I will ask, what is she truly feeling? Like, or I guess, what is she worried about?
Hmm. Okay. So you're like sizing up this newcomer, and you mentioned, I think, like just loud enough for her to hear, like, we should stay out of this. Like, this is not our fight. So that tips you off as like someone who clearly can do something in this situation more than everyone else, who would be like, we're done. They wouldn't even say anything. They would just leave. So she's already like suspicious of you. And what she's worried about is that you all are going to make trouble for her trying to do business. Okay. So like she was confident walking in here and seeing all of you and kind of like getting a vibe off of you in return was like, okay, this was going to be a simple errand.
Shakedown.
And now it might be a thing. Right.
Okay.
So she's a little intimidated by you.
I would know what's going on just instinctively. Oh, yes. Yeah.
You've seen a shakedown 100 times. What do you do?
All right. This is out of character, but inside mentally. It's just like I'm trying to do the calculations on whether or not if this will help the person. Because, yeah, we could help them this one time, but that's not going to stop the person from repeatedly coming over back again.
And who's to say we won't make it worse for the next time they come, right?
The next time they come. So I know these two, they have a very strong sense of justice. Oh, I'm conflicted. Oh, so conflicted.
Well, why are you
honestly
conflicted?
I might be actually trying to hide my face a little bit.
Yeah, like. Yeah.
Does John say anything back?
So Quan said we should stay out of this, right?
Right, yeah, that's what Quan said. Yeah,
I think Jen's like, oh, what is it? What's going on?
Quan leans in and is like,
I think someone owes someone something.
I don't know. I don't like these guys.
I'll go ahead and whisper. I'll just try and hide a whisper. Protection money. That's what they're doing, protection money.
And as it almost on cue, the leader of the gang like walks over to the counter and is like, how long does it take you to count out your coins, Willow? You're not that bad at math, are you? It's simple. You pay, we leave. Chop, chop. And Willow's
forward,
like fumbling for stuff. What do you do? Yeah. John, this must be a hard moment for you. What do you do?
I'm gonna step forward and say, hey, how about you leave anyway?
Yeah.
We're in the middle of something here.
She turns right around, and you feel two big presences behind you of like two of the big toughs.
Quan's stepping
behind you.
If two of them step behind him, Quan's gonna step up.
Right. So everyone's like starting to get on edge.
Yeah.
And she turns around and she like laughs incredulously, like, excuse me? We should just leave? I'm sorry, you must be new here. And I can tell by the way that you're dressed that you're not from around here. Okay.
Quan steps up and like interrupts as she says, you're not from around here. I can tell by the way you're dressed. Quan steps up and kind of gets in front of / in between Jean and this lady and is like,
well, he might not be, but I am. Now you heard what he said. We have business here. Important business. And she holds up her symbol again.
Yeah. That sounds like some intimidate.
Yeah. Some intimidation, I think, is happening here. Technically, I am protecting Chi as well.
Yeah.
Would that count?
Yeah. Right.
So I get the plus
now that
one
I've put
forward.
Us all in danger.
No, it's good. It's a good move. It's a good move.
10.
Hey!
Nice.
Ooh.
Nice.
Okay. Oof. So on a hit, she's going to choose from the list of options. But because you rolled a 10 plus, you can choose one thing that she can't do. So she either can't run to escape or get backup. She can't back down but keep watch. She can't give in with stipulations. Or she can't attack you but off balance.
I'd say she can't run and get backup.
Okay, yeah. So she's going to choose to attack you but off balance.
Okay.
So you, everyone, the tension has been building in this room of like, hey, back off. You told me to back off? No, I'm going to get my people to gang up around you. Okay, Willow's like, okay, let me get behind the counter even more. Maybe I get behind the printing press somewhere. And she points her finger at your badge. And it's like, listen here, Chen dog. Your badge doesn't mean anything in lower ring. Okay? This block is Razor Ning's territory. I don't care what kind of fancy badges you want to flash around here. The only thing I answer to is coin and steel. And she draws this long Jian sword, your namesake. Actually, no, it's a ninja toe. So it's like a shorter sword with kind of a box hilt, but it's like a thin blade.
Mm-hmm.
And she pulls it out and she swings at you. So, what we're going to do is drop into an exchange. I was wondering when this is going to happen this session. I think here we are. So the way that fighting works in Avatar Legends, is unlike other PBTA games, which are sort of like very, I do a thing, it's fluid, there's a move. One move could resolve an entire conflict. To represent the sort of flurry of attacks and choreographed fights of Avatar, we have a bit of a, like a rock, paper, scissors type system with techniques that we choose for how we want to do things. So what we're going to do is have everyone who's participating in this flurry of action, because it's like 3 to 5 seconds of strikes, right? Is going to pick what they want to do. Either defend, attack, or evade. And there are techniques that you can choose from within there. And what I'm going to do as the GM is choose secretly approaches for the NPCs for what they're going to do. So you're going to choose kind of and try and figure out like what you want to do. So I right now am going to mark out some options here. And everyone who is participating in this immediate burst as Ning draws her sword and lashes out at Quan. What are you going to do?
Quan is going to use that attack as a way to seize a position.
Okay, so you're going to advance an attack is your plan.
Mm-hmm.
Defend and maneuver is that technique. So what you're going to do is choose the approach, and then we'll roll and see what you get to do as a result of it. So your general approach here is to defend and maneuver, which makes sense. She's coming at you. You're going to try and get out of the way. Jian.
It's an advance. It's in the advance and attack section.
Seize a position should be under defend and maneuver in the new rules.
Do you have an old version of the book?
I'm looking at the character sheet.
The character sheet should be...
Is it good or wrong?
It might be
based on an older set of the rules. Because techniques are... What we're playing is the quick start rules, which are kind of shifting around. Some things are changing and modifying. The current rule...
They've got an outdated version. They've got defend and response as one.
That is an older version.
Okay.
So if you want to seize a position, that's under defend and maneuver now.
Okay.
But generally speaking, that's like... you're
it's
trying
on,
to evade.
It's on page 21 of the.
Yeah.
Of the
I'm trying to like story. Move to a different location and avoid their hit. Yeah.
Yeah.
Get myself into a good, better, advantageous.
Position. A more advantageous position for sure. Yeah. Gian, are you going to try and defend and maneuver, advance and attack, or evade and observe?
I've got to do advance and attack. It's just
okay,
it's just right
there.
There
as well.
I'm a hammer and these are nails. Let's go.
Yeah. And Chi, are you going to defend and maneuver, advance and attack, or evade and observe?
Honestly, I think if it's all about like we gotta strike fast and quick in these kind of situations, I am also gonna be on for the attack. I'm gonna maneuver for
Cool. So what we're going to do is resolve each of these approaches in order from defend to attack to evade. So even though we're resolving them in order, they're happening kind of more or less all at the same time in the fight. What I'm going to reveal is that Ning, Razor Ning, of course, is advancing and attacking. And her goons are defending and maneuvering. So first, everyone who defends and maneuvers gets to go, which is going to be Quan. So go ahead and roll with your focus, and that'll determine kind of what you're able to pull off this turn.
8.
Okay. So on a 7 to 9, you get to use a basic or mastered technique, and you can choose from either the three options that are here, which are ready, which lets you kind of create some status effects around the environment for people. You can retaliate, which is if someone attacks, you can kind of hit them back. Or you can seize a position, which is to move to a new location. So like engaging or disengaging foes, overcoming negative statuses. Like if someone's like impairs you somehow, you can try and break that. Gain a new position or escape the scene or anything like that. However,
I want to get to a position that's gonna be better for me, so maybe like the height advantage by like jumping up, like she kind of like does a flip and is standing now on top of the table instead of being like in between Jean and her.
Yeah, like on the counter or like up in the rafters maybe or something like that.
Yeah.
Okay, so you're gonna try and like dodge out of the way and like leap up onto the thing. The other thing you can do, and you don't have to choose, but you can. Every character playbook gets a special technique that is unique to their playbook. In the final game, you may be able to choose at character creation from them that are attached to your fighting style, like a special firebending technique or a special weapon technique. As the guardian, you have divert, which lets you step into the way of blows intended for allies. So if you roll very well on your approach, you can both retaliate and divert. So you're like parrying strikes and blocking them for people and then hitting people back twice as good, which is very fun. But you're getting into a better position that's going to kind of throw her off. So you're getting a height advantage. Great. That's what you're doing. So we see Quan doing like bobbing and weaving out of the way of the sword strikes and then jumping up to a higher position. Everyone who's advancing and attacking gets to go. So we're going to have PCs go first. So Gian, go ahead and roll with your passion.
Okay. Ten.
Okay, hey. Very spicy. So this lets you choose to use two basic or mastered techniques. So you can't pick the same thing twice in an exchange. You can't strike twice at once. But if you're advancing and attacking, you could strike and pressure. You could pressure and smash. You could strike and smash. Those are the three basic techniques. Or, because you're the hammer, you have a special technique.
Overwhelm, yeah.
Overwhelm, which you can use when you advance and attack, which lets you stun a foe.
It does. What happens when you max fatigue again?
If you fill your fatigue track, whenever you mark additional fatigue after that, you start taking conditions.
Because that's the fun thing, is it's I already have two fatigue from helping out various roles, and it overwhelmed marks three, so I'll immediately be maxed out. But I'll still be standing.
You'll be standing, and you'll have stunned your opponent, who will be like unable to do anything for a couple of moments. So it's up to you. You can do two basics, or a basic and overwhelm.
Ooh. I think I'm gonna do it. I'm gonna go for overwhelm.
Okay, sweet. So you're gonna mark three fatigue, and you're gonna inflict the stunned condition on her. Are you attacking?
I'm gonna
Razor Ning.
Yeah, I feel like the smart thing to do would be to deal with the two people on either shoulder, but the Zhan thing to do is to attack the person in front of him.
It's the biggest threat, right? So what does this look like as you use your overwhelm attack?
Is this like a stone floor in here? Like sort of bare rock? Excellent. I imagine it is in most places in the Earth Kingdom, because why would you not have bendable flooring unless you don't want it to be bent by somebody else?
They're like stone flagstones, yeah.
I go for like the classic, like the most practiced, like, so like Earth Kingdom soldier move, which is like I get into position, I stomp, it kicks up a block of earth, and then I just punch it.
Yeah, perfect. Boom, boom, and it'll smash into her, and just throw her backwards. Right.
And then
you still have another technique. You're right.
Yeah.
So what's the basic?
I probably will now actually deal with one of the guys behind me. let's do. Yeah, I'm gonna do a strike on yep. the guy. Let's say like over my right shoulder is like when I see this lady go down. I remember that there's other people around me, and I'm gonna turn and go for like a punch on this guy.
Yeah, so you like wheel around and turn that momentum into a strike here. So when you strike, you force them to either mark two fatigue, a condition, or shift their balance away from their center, because NPCs can have balance tracks just like players. Hmm. If you want, you can mark fatigue to choose to hammer them with their blows and force them to take a specific thing. Like, I want to wear them down. I want to make them mark fatigue, or I want to make them mark a condition. However, because you just filled your track, you're so drained from that initial rush that you can't choose to mark fatigue. So right. they get to choose
it's only
what
like
happens.
When I'm forced to take fatigue, I would take something else, but otherwise I can't voluntarily. So yeah, exactly. They can choose then.
Right. So they are going to take... they're going to take fatigue as you like turn around and you swing... Right, there's a bunch of them, so they can sort of soak it. Like, so they take two fatigue on their track. Chi, were you evading or attacking?
I was attacking.
You're attacking. Okay, so go ahead and roll with your passion. Let's see what happens to you.
Passion, go.
Oof. Oh.
Okay, so it's a miss. On a miss. You're gonna stumble, but you can shift your balance away from center to use a basic technique.
I will do that. Was that a minus or a plus to that?
So your balance should be at zero right now, right?
Yes.
Okay. You're gonna shift your balance track one step in either direction, so either towards confidence or loyalty, whichever principle you feel like you're embodying the most right now.
Loyalty. Cause...
Right, you're working with friends, you're like defending everyone, you're trying to work together. So you can use a basic technique from the advance and attack as you're like, oh, my friends!
My friends!
Do you want to strike, pressure, or smash?
Smash.
Okay, so smash lets you mark a fatigue to destroy or destabilize something in the environment, possibly or inflict or overcoming a fictionally appropriate positive or negative
sense. So I'm not a great fighter physically this close. So what I'm going to do is block the doorway with my body plus the other person's body by just kind of like tackling them in so nobody else can come into the shop while we're doing this. So it's only like the, yeah. Mm. Is that possible?
I think,
because that makes it so others can't get in.
Right. I think what you can do is you're not destroying the door.
No.
You are destabilizing it.
I mean, a body's destabilizing the door if it's shoved up against it, right? Yeah.
If you're trying to like pin a guy down.
Yeah. Or just kind of like human
stop block.
That's more
of a strike.
Oh, okay. No, yeah.
Because if you were trying to like break the door or break an object or disrupt something like that, that would be one thing.
I don't want to break their stuff. I'll
seizing
do a, strike,
a position
then.
Would be a little bit more of like, now we can't do whatever.
Okay.
You could pressure them and try to intimidate them or impress them too.
Sure, let's do that. We'll pressure them so they just run out and not actually fight.
Okay, so choose an approach that they can't use if this exchange continues. Can they not advance and attack, defend and maneuver, or evade and observe?
Advance and attack. I don't want them to be able to attack. Yeah.
And so I think fictionally what you're doing is like, what you remind us what your fighting style is, because this is the first time we're seeing you throw your skills around.
Yeah. So out of just nowhere, like, just like more like knives just like pop out like daggers, and I'm just going up pressing like these two blades against, like, hey kid, you want to fight, look at this, you said you answered with steel, this is very nice steel, you know how close it is to your throat right now.
Right, so you're like blocking strikes and you kind of shove people up against things, mm-hmm. Maybe you throw a couple of daggers that like pin someone's arm to the wall.
Yes.
You know,
it's exactly. Just a lot of like pincushion explosion kind of thing and
throwing knives everywhere. I think Susu is like poking out of your tunic and like does the little throwing gesture with you.
Yes.
Together. That's the animation cell. And so they can't attack next exchange because they're too busy like, I'm pinned. I can't. What's going on? For everybody else, I said the NPCs were going to defend and maneuver, which I didn't do, which I should be doing. And I think they were going to seize a position. So retroactively, what they were going to do is try and block the exit anyway.
Ah.
It's like, they're trying to, like, they're backing their boss up, but they're not rushing in. They're like, like, we're going to make an example out of you. So they move to block your ways out. So they're blocking the doors, the back entrance and everything like that. And then, while they're so spread out, that's a perfect time for Chi to be like, knives everywhere, chunk, 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 chunk. Shouldn't have done that. For the advance and attacker NPC, which is Razor Ning, she is going to strike at Quan, unsurprisingly.
Is this before the stun? Or...
Yeah, so everything resolves kind of at the same time.
Oh, okay.
So if you inflict a stun on someone, it takes place sort of after the exchange.
Right.
Like as a result.
Yeah, that
of
makes
it.
Sense. Yeah, everyone yeah. acts at once and then
everyone gets to act, right. Which means if you it applies to NPCs too, but if you as a PC get taken out during an exchange, you still get to take a turn, you still get to do something. It's just in the moment of like that super cool 5 seconds of trading blows and fight choreography. Hmm. It happens. And then that last frame is like someone getting kicked against a wall. Right. So she is going to choose to mark fatigue, and inflict a condition on Quan. So she's got the sword out and she's swinging like swing, 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 swing. And even if she doesn't hit you, the speed at which she attacks is like, whoa, hold on. It throws you off. I think maybe she like cuts part of your sleeve with her sword at one point.
All right, I think I will mark the angry condition.
That makes sense. But all of this resolves of like, right, she rushes in, swing, swing, swing. Quan, dodging and weaving, jumps up to high ground, has the advantage, drops into that fighting stance. I'm like, okay, you can retaliate. The gang tries to block the exits, but they're rapidly pinned back by Chi. And also a few cheap shots get laid in by John, who then wheels around and then kicks that rock up and bam, smashes Razor Ning up into the wall and just goes tumbling head over heels. She's stunned. So that's the exchange. That's that exchange. Now we go back into general play and Ning can't do anything. Ning's like groggily like,
anyone get the name of that? Crocogator.
It's like stumbling around. The gang is like either pinned up or like, whoa, and looks up at Quan, who's looking down at them from this elevated position and clearly like armed and ready to fight. Like, whoa, hold on. It doesn't need to be like this. What do you do?
Quan will jump down and like hover over the top of Razor Ning and say,
well, it looks like you've been bested. So I think that you and your goons should be on their way and never return here again.
She like groggily looks up at you, sees that you have very much the upper hand, and just growls, like bares her teeth. She's all bruised up, right? She gets to her feet. She grabs the sword and kind of like cautiously, like she's got it kind of crossing her body, like backs up in a defensive position.
Quan is like holding her yin yang tomahawk and it lights on fire a little bit.
She sees the flame glint across the blade and her eyes go like double wide, like in confusion and fear. Like she was worried you were going to be a problem before. Now she knows you can firebend, which is very confusing to her. And she like walks all the way backwards to the door. The rest of the gang is like ripped their sleeves loose and is like huddling almost behind her. And she puts the blade in her belt where it was before, kind of across the back. Like, my money. It's not over, Willow.
Oh, it's over.
She roars the flame. Step forward and
like raise my hands again. Like,
you step forward again.
Oh, it's not over, is it? One.
The flame licks across the blade.
Got my blade and, out.
Right, you've got all your knives. Susu is doing like mimicking your little I'm
on the top of my
position on your shoulder, like, and she's like. Kicks some dirt and like storms out, leaving you in this.
Quan will help the lady up and apologize.
I'm sorry for the mess that has ensued in here. If we can help, we shall.
Oh, you don't have to do that. You did enough by getting her off my back. I mean, I know I'm behind in my payments, but
what exactly are you paying for?
Protection.
From who?
Everyone. The guards only get so far down here, and they don't patrol that much in this neighborhood. It's hard for us. We don't have all those lovely gardens and parties and all the money that they do in the middle ring and even the upper ring. not that I mean any disrespect to you, or the House of Chen. It's just that, well, down here, people make their living however they can. Sometimes it's better the devil you know.
Is this, I'm gonna go, not to be rude, but comment. Is this gonna cause, they're gonna be back. Is this gonna cause you more trouble? Are you gonna be okay?
She brushes some hair off from her face to the side a little bit, kind of looks up at you with like a little more doughy eyes. Like, well, I don't know if they'll be back. You did put on a good show. I hope not.
Let me see. I'm gonna look at my trinkets that I have. I've been holding on to. I'll kind of choose one of the more expensive ones and be like, take this and, you know, make it clean and figure out if you need emergency funds.
Thank you. I don't know what to say. And she like pockets it and she goes over to the printing press to make sure it's all right. And she kind of like lifts it up, and it, as she's taking some of the stuff that she was printing on, the screen prints out, she's like is resetting it. She kind of gently lowers it and she looks at all of you like, you're not just here. You're not really here from the Chens, are you?
Yes and no.
We are here on behalf of all of the Earth Kingdom.
And she senses kind of what you're saying, and she smiles as like she's like, John especially is like, oh, really worried. And she's like, if you're here for all of the Earth Kingdom, if you're here for Ba Sing Se, that's good enough for me. Let's make some posters. Click. Cut to black. Chugga 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 credit music.
Love it.
And that's where we'll leave it for this week.
All right, awesome. Okay then, we will wrap up for today. We'll go and record an after show, of course, that you'll be able to check out on Patreon in a couple days. Keep an eye on the Twitter for when that gets posted. But we'll do the announcements, and then we'll go through where you can find everyone and check for tips. So announcements are that today's episode was supported by Hero Sheep. Thank you very much for supporting episode 1 of our Avatar show. You can find some stuff going on the Patreon. We have the final character sheets for Mage up on the Patreon right now, as is the character sheet for Queenie, our latest guest on Dungeons & Dragons Ascension, played by Satine T-Rex. Phoenix. Yep, giant pink barred T-Rex. What more could you want out of a guest? There's more stuff coming as well. There'll be some more GM secret stuff from E about the Mage show. And there's also a monthly recap for the last month that will be up in the coming week. We're also sponsored by Roll20. It's the service that we use to play our tabletop RPGs online. Super convenient, and we were just able to grab a character sheet that someone in the Roll20 community had made. As it turns out, they made it a little bit longer ago than I thought they had. I'll have to see if I can get an updated version that has the right combat rules, but otherwise it's a super easy way of rolling dice with friends online. And check our pinned tweets from time to time to see if we've got any giveaways going on, because we give out some rule books on Roll20 every now and then. You'll also very soon be able to check out the MP3 and after show for Ascension. Those will be up on Patreon very shortly. I'll of course be posted on the socials as well, so you'll be able to check that out. Latest episodes after show. No. What kind of cat is that? It's got to be a combo. It's got to be a something cat. I can't think of anything though.
She's a Earth cat.
like a fox cat, bear cat.
Fox so cat, bear cat.
Yeah, let's go through where you can find people. Let's start with our GM. Where can we find you in the rest of your week, and what kind of things are you up to?
Oh, well, okay. Thanks for having me. I'm delighted to keep telling the story with y'all. Again, my name's Simon. You can find me on Twitter at Lucha Libris. I write and publish tabletop role-playing games at colorspurgames.itch.io. I'm a voice actor for the queer sci-fi and fantasy audio drama The Penumbra Podcast. If you want to hear yourself represented in stories, that's at The Penumbra Pod on Twitter, thepenumbrapodcast.com. I'm also a cast member for All Nerds Here on Twitch. We're on hiatus, but follow us on Twitter to get notified when we launch our new season of mostly BIMPOC queer games. And that's what I do.
Awesome. And Maggie, what are you up to? Where can we find you?
Hey, I'm Margaret Crone. You can find me at Margaret Crone in all the places. I do lots of tabletop RPG stuff. The next thing that I have going on is next Tuesday, I will be over at the Bubbernaz channel at around like 6 p.m. Pacific, and we will be playing Pathfinder, but I'm in 4 campaigns a week, so if you want more, there's more. Come check it out. And if you give me a follow, I'll let you know whenever I'm live for all of that jazz. And beyond that, I make video games for a living. I'm currently working on a project called Ashes of Creation, and you can find it everywhere at Ashes of Creation. Sorry, I'm trying to keep the cat from putting her tail in the camera. She's just like being crazy right now.
Banzai, where can we find you and what are you up to?
Hello, I am Banzai Baby here on Twitch. I do a lot of woodworking. If you want, I also do a lot of like different RPGs. You want to follow me on Twitter just to see all the shows I'm going to be in at Banzai Baby, because gosh darn it, that person won't give me my Twitter tag. Anywho, but yeah, and you also can find me on Gen Con as well in the lyric. But yeah, just follow my Twitter to really figure out where I'm going, because I hop around everywhere.
I know that nomadic life.
Yeah.
And I am Bentham. I also don't have the Twitter handle that I would like. There is an at Bentham out there, and he's made like 9 tweets, and they're follower only, and he has like 2 followers. So one day I'll get it. One day I'll beat him. For now, I'm Bentham, please. You can find me, and that's the better of my names. You can find me in other places under the worst of my names, where on YouTube and Twitch I'm known as Mangled Pork, and there I play video games. We've been playing lots of multiplayer stuff recently. We got Space Engineers, we got Phasmophobia. Tomorrow we'll be doing Barotrauma. That's my phone, shush. We'll be doing Barotrauma tomorrow, multiplayer, as we've been doing a campaign. And also recently I played Breakwaters, which is a new early access game coming out soon. It's like a survival crafting, but you can manipulate water. You can like push it out the way, and you can like walk on the ocean floor using magic, I think. We haven't got that far, but apparently you can do that. I'm excited.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's what I've been up to. More of that kind of thing, and that's me. So with that, we're going to go and record an after show. Yes. We'll see you next week. I'm checking, and I think we're good. But yeah, we'll... Okay. We'll see you next week for the next episode. You'll also find Roll Fritz next time on Thursday with more Dungeons & Dragons Ascension. And you'll soon be able to catch the after show on Patreon.
We are going
to
have Patrick on.
We are going to have Patrick Static.
My brother! We're
going to
find
guest.
My brother! We've only waited for how many episodes to find my brother?
I mean...
It's like hundreds now.
it's been over a year of playing... I forget exactly when we learned that he was out there to be rescued, but we've been trying for a long time. It's going to happen this week.
Yeah. 21 years. Yes, in game.
We shall say goodbye, and may the dice roll ever in your favor.